Ladies and gentlemen, it's Wednesday, the 8th day of June 2016. We have just seen an incredibly historical event take place with Donald Trump getting more votes than any Republican ever has to completely clinch the nomination. We've also seen the organized criminal with a longer trail of sinister activities than anybody I've ever seen in history get the nomination. Yeah, we've had some bad presidents commit a lot of crimes once they get into office, but this woman is a master criminal, and it is another victory for gimmicks. We have the black president, now it's a woman president. How'd that black president work out for African Americans? Double unemployment. This is a total screw job, but she's stolen the election clearly from Sanders. We're going to cover it all today. We have a jam-packed transmission. But first, I just tweeted this out. It's so important. This video could bring down Hillary Clinton. John Bount reports on the organized crime syndicate master now in control.
Prepare yourself for the main event. Hillary Clinton has, by most accounts, clinched the Democratic presidential nomination, dragging her mountainous pile of scandals into the last round to possibly make her the next president of the United States. Hillary's rise to the White House is akin to Richard Nixon in reverse. This is the same woman who recently gave a speech on income inequality wearing a $12,000 Armani jacket. The same woman who, according to a Secret Service account, punched Bill Clinton so hard she gave him a black eye. Granted, Bill probably deserved it, but that is only one clear example of the temperament that could quite possibly have access to 1,750 active nuclear warheads.
She's got health issues, and they're going back and asking me and others that have known her since the beginning, What is it about Hillary? And Hillary, Alex, has had a mental issue since day one. She does not like people. She is an animal. She's everything I've told you she is. And it is a mental problem. And that's what's causing her trouble running this election, to be quite honest. You can't make her a people person. You just can't do it. And so that's where we're at. But there's going to be stories about that. But remember, none of these things are going to hurt Hillary. None.
And the Secret Service desperately wants Americans to know that the real Hillary Clinton is a monster. According to Page Six, Secret Service agent Gary Byrne writes in his new tell-all book that Hillary repeatedly screamed obscenities at her husband, Secret Service personnel, and White House staffers, all of whom lived in terror of her next tirade. Secret Service agents had discussions about the possibility that they would have to protect Bill from his wife's physical attacks, Burns writes. And the couple had one violent encounter the morning of a key presidential address to the nation. Will Hillary spend the first 100 days of her presidency pardoning herself and permanently silencing her husband's accusers, simultaneously sicking the IRS and the FBI on the Clintons' enemies? Here are just a few of the unanswered scandals that will surface yet again when Hillary is president, courtesy of WorldNet Daily. Vince Foster's 1993 death, Benghazi, Whitewater, Emailgate, Chinagate, Travelgate, Pardongate, the Clinton body count, where 91% of the Clinton Foundation's money really went. Hillary's assistant, Muslim Brotherhood tied Huma Abedin's involvement with the Saudis to establish a Muslim America, and we could be here all day if I just kept on going. But it appears stealing the Democratic presidential nomination is child's play to the career criminal known as Hillary Rodham Clinton. The Clintons even attempted to loot the White House when Bill's term ended. The Clintons tried to take $190,000 from the presidential mansion in furniture and gifts, attempting to have it shipped back to the Clintons' Chappaqua, New York home. And according to the General Accounting Office, the cost of the White House vandalism reached about $14,000. The agency said some of the destruction was intentional, including glue smeared on desks, broken furniture, offices full of trash and graffiti in a men's restroom stall that disparaged Bush. There were also missing doorknobs, medallions, and office signs. Is there any question that Hillary will sign away any remaining sovereignty the United States has left to her globalist overlords, acting as the cleanup crew for Obama's two-term facade of a presidency, carrying on the Bush presidency's unyielding New World Order disintegration of the U.S. Constitution? John Baum for InfoWars.com.
Get the video out. It's on InfoWars.com. Well, we have seen unprecedented developments in our constitutional republic that is under siege. Hillary Clinton undoubtedly has stolen the election from Bernie Sanders. I hate Bernie Sanders. I don't just get up here and say that they've stolen it from him because I just want to say that. It's a fact we're going to go over today. It was done in plain view. Even New York Daily News and other major liberal publications admit that he got more votes across the country than Hillary. And mind you, that's with them stealing elections day one in places like New Hampshire, where he would win by 20 points but get less delegates than Hillary. So that creates the perception, oh, don't vote for him, he can't win. That's what they hoped to do, stealing it early. People didn't care. They still went for Bernie Sanders because they hate Hillary so much. And I've bashed Bernie supporters until I've gone out in public and seen people wearing Bernie shirts. And most of them are listeners. And they're like, listen, we want to audit the Fed. We like you. We like Ron Paul. You know, we know he's pretty extreme on socialism, but we think he's anti-establishment, which he clearly is. They're going after him. And so I got to give it to Bernie Sanders. It's hard to say that. It is hard to say that. For not giving up last night and saying he's going to keep going forward. Now, he's saying he's going to keep fighting to have power at the convention for the platform. No, buddy, you need to come out and take the gloves off and say, I won New Hampshire. I won the... Over 10 states, they admit that he won, where the superdelegates met in secret and then decided who the delegates voted for. And by the way, in California, Leanne McAdoo was there for 2 days. She's still there today. 80% or more of the people, she's putting together a report on it, of just hundreds of interviews, exit polls, you name it, said, no, I'm voting for Bernie Sanders. In fact, for a day, she couldn't find anybody on the street that was for Hillary. She had to go to polling places to find some and to Hillary rallies with bigs to find them. They were all there last night for the Hillary rally, all of it. They're going to be on air with us today, a huge broadcast, but wow, wow. I mean, forget Hillary, forget Sanders, forget Trump, okay? Forget all that. We are at a point where they are now implementing rules that they never implemented to say your vote doesn't count. Now, the good news is when the Republicans tried it with Donald Trump, with a confidence game going, of course your vote never counted, it blew up in their face. They had to back off with the force feeding they try to engage in of Kasich and Cruz and the rest of it. With Democrats, though, it remains to be seen, and they're saying the AP is warning its reporters of violent Bernie supporters. The police are bracing in Philadelphia for the crisis of the Bernie supporters. Everyone is scared of the Bernie supporters. They're coming. They're so evil. Now, they have attacked our reporters. They have beat people up. So have Hillary supporters. They are socialists. They are stupid. They think they're getting something for free, many of them. Those that aren't just protest voting. They're angry, like you're robbing something from them because you're not going to put Bernie in and you're going to keep them from their free ride, their free lunch. But when you do steal the popular vote from people, it becomes a dictatorial situation. And then that's the only time violence begins to become a discussional issue. I mean, what are Bernie supporters supposed to do when they go vote for Bernie and then Hillary gets it? And I'm not advocating violence, let's be clear. I'm simply saying at some point we're going down a road that now we understand why they want our guns, because if it's going to be so dictatorial, it's going to get bad and we won't have a choice but to defend ourselves. Now, the good news is Obama clearly wanted to have martial law. He tried to get special forces and regular army and Marines openly ready for it. They even tried to put it in the news the last few years like it was no big deal. Oh, we got internet kill switches and re-education camps. They use that term, Soviet term. And yeah, we're training for insurrection to take over some cities and go after the Tea Party and veterans and gun owners and Christians. You saw all those stories. We tell you about it 8 years ago. They deny it. Now they go, yeah, that's what we're gearing up for. But what happens when you train the regular Army, the regular Marines, and even Air Force security in that? A lot of them wake up. Then you train Special Forces people whose motto is free the oppressed, stuff like that. That's the Army's motto in Latin. I'm paraphrasing from memory. Will you guys pull up the Green Beret motto? I believe it's defender, free the oppressed. I'm going from memory. SAS is fortune favors the bold. But The issue is, you think that woke them up when they were openly briefed? Yeah, we're looking at taking over governorships. We're looking at installing governors. That's why the military is so incredibly awake now and listens to this show, because it's the only place they can tune in to hear what they actually heard behind closed doors. And they go, that guy knows everything down to the exact words. That's because I've reverse engineered their whole program for 20 years. The first year on air, I wasn't that informed, but a lot of old timers and people that had been in the military and in COG and in higher levels of government, they knew about it because these plans had been developed earlier, but not on a mass scale. They had developed the plans and had them, very limited groups were aware of them, maybe a few thousand people. Now they're trying to get tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people ready to move with these COG takeover plans. And it is the biggest Bremen hot cup of high-octane coffee to wake people up this country's ever seen. So the globalists have made some miscalculations, but they've got their Black Lives Matters, communist groups, and others warmed up and ready for civil insurrection. That'll get mainline patriots of every race, color, and creed to support the military on the streets, because you'll need the military on the streets. But that's phase one. Once that's established, then they stage false flags, they blame the patriots, then they start trying to arrest patriots, and the military has to know that's the plan, and they do know that's the plan. So good luck running that plan, New World Order. So we're in kind of a Mexican standoff here. They'll say, oh, that's racist. That's how mentally ill political correctness has gotten now, where you say, give me a white Russian. Why are you bashing Russians? No, it's a Russian drink, or a Moscow mule, or a Mexican standoff is a term out of Mexico, of where you got everybody pointing guns at each other in a room so that nobody can, you know, make a move without knowing they're about to get it. The most famous Mexican standoff is in the film The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly with Lee Van Cleef. And I forget the great actor that plays Tuco. And then, of course, the immortal Clint Eastwood. But I digress. And that's what we're in, is a gigantic Mexican standoff of the New World Order. Because they want to run this whole takeover program and not have people there reporting on it and exposing it. They're running a paradigm that's based on them controlling all the media. Now, because they don't control it, they go, well, we'll just start censoring it and we'll start blocking it out. No, ladies and gentlemen, because we're aware of that program, so your attempt to move in with that only stirs up the hornet's nest that much more. So here's the bottom line. We're not winning the war, but we are in a Mexican standoff, and we are gaining momentum, and the enemy knows that. So the answer is to ram it into turbo gear, take off all the governors, fix our will on restoring the human awakening, and we can have a new renaissance right like that. Because it's a spiritual deception that's over these zombies out there that don't know which end is up. It's not just educational. It's not just cultural. It is a spirit of jellyfish behavior. I watched last night during the live coverage for 4 hours. The crew did a great job. Our reporters all over the world, from Germany to California to right here in Austin, and our anchors doing a wonderful job. And I, in between watching the live feed, I watched clip after clip of the people that Leanne's interviewing. The Hillary supporters and the Bernie supporters, these are the most infantile, jellyfish-like, sad, stupid, unironic people. These are victims. And I really almost cried. Look what they've done to them. But I just want to see light back in their eyes. I want to see them understand what real prosperity is. I want to see them just have some basic understanding of what's being done to them. And I want to see them awake and alive. I'm telling you, liberals, I don't care if they're black, white, or Hispanic, or Asian, they all look like somebody sucked the soul out of them. Look, there's no fire in their eyes. They stutter. They can hardly talk. They don't know geography, politics. They just know how to say LGBT, homophobe, racist, transphobic, we need tranny bathrooms. I mean, look what they've done to them. Look what this dependence has done to them. And I'm not defending conservatism. That's its own wrecked, mentally ill, you know, rhino-run thing. But, I mean, these people are all just gibbering idiots who think they're in power because Hillary's about to win. or think they're in power because Bernie's about to win, who are getting reflected glory from it and feel like they're succeeding. These are children. These are childlike minds. They are victims. They are like a child climbing in a perv van thinking they're about to pet a puppy and get some candy. And really, culturally, incrementally, they're about to be hung up by their feet, their throats slit, their guts hung out, and wolves are about to dine on them at their extreme leisure. Okay, I got to stop the ranting. There's like 15 clips. I've got so many guests coming on today. This is incredible. This is so amazing. Infowars.com is busting open with intel. We have got so much election news. We've got incredible Donald Trump clips that I must air. And then let me just tell you what's coming up today. Rob Dew and Paul Watson from Dresden outside Bilderberg. Alex Newman popping in on the plan of Agenda 21 for the feds to invade every county and city to, quote, diversify them. That's building little command bases and then bringing in the homeless and welfare people to create total breakdown. Then we've got Roger Stone popping in, he said, with huge intrigue. Then we've got Dr. Edward Group popping in with big medical news. Leanne McAdoo and Joe Biggs and then David Knight and more. And I've got so many clips, so much news, so much economic news. It is an ultra-massive transmission. Be sure and stay in contact with us. Everybody needs to sign up for our newsletter at Infowars.com/newsletter. It's free. Sign up now. We've got huge Bilderberg developments on the cashless society that they're pushing, on imploding Europe, similar model for imploding our borders. Our reporters, Paul Watson and Rob Dew, will be reporting, popping up in the next segment. I have other incredible news here that's going to be coming up in the next segment. Wait till you hear this. The police are now, already started this in Oklahoma, using electronic card readers at a distance that beam at you and then suck the money out of your credit cards, basically a hacking device that criminals have used previously, claiming if you owe the government money, they just take it right away. Or if they think you've been caught with something illegal, they just take your money on the spot. This is all part of the federal asset forfeiture seizure garbage. This is the police state. This is pure evil. And the police need to reverse this and oppose this. You know, we're not here just hating the police because that just helps the globalist overall. We hate the people running the police that are stomping on our Constitution. Another article just went up on Infowars.com. Napolitano, FBI plan to access browser history, major steps towards police state. So that's coming up. But right now, let me get into the election news. This is big. Let me look at the stack of news. I'm going to come back, play some Trump clips, and then go to Germany with our reporter standing by. Clinton, Trump debate will be a singular moment in American history. And if he savages her, he will defeat her. The problem is if she's robbing Bernie Sanders, she'll try to rob Trump. And Trump has had record numbers now, over 3 million people in the Republican Party that weren't there previous. Hillary, get this, has less voters this time, I'm going to get to that article, than she did last time losing the nomination. But it doesn't matter. She has superdelegates. Oh. Democratic primaries. Clinton claims nomination victory. Washington Post. She claims it. Now everybody else went, historic moment. And all these weird men got there and went, I think it's great women are now in charge. Oh, yeah, women are now in charge. I'd love to have a woman president if she was a patriot. It's not about her being a woman. She's a crime boss, for heaven's sakes. Rasmussen, superdelegate system created to keep outsiders like Sanders out. Duh. Absolutely. That's from Newsmax. And then here it is, even out of New York Daily News. Super liberal. Hillary Clinton has not won the Democratic primary. Boom. And then it goes on to say a group of superdelegates met in secret, and then they decided what the delegates came and told them what the numbers were, and then they put that on the news that she'd won. Just like they did in New Hampshire. Except there, they said Sanders won, but a day later said, sorry, yeah, by 20 points, but she gets the delegates. And they had arrogant superdelegates on TV going, yeah, I count. Okay. And that's why I'm wearing today on air the Hillary for President shirt. Usually wearing a sports jacket in here to respect the show, but, you know, it's time. Hillary for President. For all of her crimes, it's hundreds of them that are admitted. It's incredible. On Monday, on the eve of the most important day in the primary, on a day where not a single vote was cast. Hillary Clinton was surprisingly declared the winner of the Democratic primary. Tuesday was scheduled to be the single biggest day of the entire Democratic primary, but it wasn't because it had already been decided. Because 694 were going to be pledged delegates up for grabs. New Jersey, North Dakota, South Dakota, Montana, New Mexico. In the past 45 days alone, more than 650,000 new voters registered in California, and the state announced 70% of available voter registration. It was the highest percentage of people ever registered for primaries in the state. This should have been a celebration of the Democratic Party as it welcomed record numbers of new voters to the fold. Instead, something far more nefarious and underhanded had happened. New voters didn't put Hillary Clinton on the top. Pledged delegates didn't steal the deal, didn't seal the deal. It wasn't a recount of primary caucuses. It was a survey, an anonymous survey. That's what said she won. This AP secret survey of superdelegates, that's what they use the next day to announce, because AP handles the vote, formerly Voter News Services, but they ran it. Now they just call it AP, and it decided. Yes, you read that correctly. A survey, the Associated Press conducted a secret survey of superdelegates in which they promised to protect their identities and determine that just enough of them, the perfect number, actually said they intended to vote for Hillary 50 days from now during the Democratic convention. And then that was announced the next day after you went and pulled the lever. Ha, ha, ha. Oh, but I'm a conspiracy theorist. I told you our government was funding Al-Qaeda in Syria and that they changed the name to ISIS to confuse people 3 years ago. And then Cy Hirsch released it in New Yorker magazine and London Review of Books and then wanted to come on my show and say, thank you, Alex, you broke some of this. You're part of the story, the Pulitzer Prize winner. And I'm not bragging. I'm just saying I got all that from the Army. That's the heroes. Oh, but I'm a conspiracy theorist when I say the superdelegates are stealing or that our government funds Al-Qaeda. No. That's a pseudo-intellectual garbage term they use for unintellectual idiots to go, oh, that's a tinfoil hat. That's a crackpot. Hillary's our lady. You're just afraid of women. Now, I'm afraid of stolen elections. There's Paul Watson right there outside the Bilderberg Group meeting hotel by the presidential imperial palace, formerly the king's palace, where the royalty is meeting. And then we're going to be talking to him here in just a moment. We have their agenda. This is huge. It's up on drudgereport.com, infowars.com, you name it. We have one of the Hillary superdelegates months and months ago, back during the New Hampshire primary, saying it doesn't matter if he wins all the votes. I'm a California superdelegate out here in New Hampshire helping run things, and I'm going to give my vote to Hillary. We got his name and everything. But you see, they just did it. And some Democrats are in the news going, this is horrible. Yes, you're going to be called a crackpot now. They'll go, there was never a vote. There was never a vote. There's the article, Kit Daniels, February 12, 2016, Hillary superdelegate. Why your vote doesn't count. You scroll down, there's the video. Bob Mulholland. We're going to play that later. Just wanted to show everybody that. I love his little arrogance, his little piggy arrogance, all the little goody indulgences and knickknacks and royal giblets, little baronies, little duchies that are doled out to little mini viceroys on a regular basis. In fact, we have the clip now. Let's just play this. Then I'll go to the guys in Germany. Then the best, most powerful Trump clips ever. But first, here is the superdelegate openly bragging to InfoWars. Here it is.
We're here at the Red Arrow Diner, and we've gone further down the bar here, and we found this gentleman. What's your name?
Bob Mulholland from Chico, California. I'm a DNC member, thus a superdelegate to the national convention.
Wow, so that's the first time I can think of that I've talked with a Democratic superdelegate. Tell us, how long have you been a superdelegate? How long have you been a delegate? And tell us a little bit more about the process of how you get to be a superdelegate.
There's several ways, but this will be my 11th national convention. I've been a superdelegate since 1992. In our case, in California, you have to get elected by the California Democratic Party to be on the DNC. Obviously, Democratic governors are automatic superdelegates.
So, understandably, that it sounds like Hillary is going to have a huge edge when it comes to superdelegates. Is that correct?
Oh, yeah, and former DNC chair chairs like Howard Dean, who's from Vermont. He's known Bernie for decades. He's for Hillary. Yeah, the people who have worked with Hillary for decades are big supporters of her. If they haven't said so yet, they will over the next several weeks.
So roughly, when it comes to the Democratic National Convention, what is the rough total of delegates that are going to be available for the DNC?
Right now, about 4,800. So you need about almost 2,400 to get the nomination. And the way we work is that anybody who gets 15% more in election gets delegates. So this election will go all the way to California. Sanders will end up with well over 1,000 delegates, and Hillary will get the nomination.
Okay, now the superdelegates are basically what Hillary...
See the full video up on Infowars.com in that original article that we should flash back. Now, he did it better than the Republicans. Priebus and Curley, whatever his name was, it was all over TV going, listen, it doesn't matter how you vote. You can do 100%. We decide. Or George Will, writing for the Washington Post, he just said, look, we don't go with a mere plurality of the public and a majority. There is sovereignty, he said, of this party. Sovereignty, royalty, royalty. Like the Bilderberg meeting in the former German royalty complex right now. Here's some of the headlines. Bilderberg leak, secretive group discuss internet ID, global tax. We're going to go to them here in just a moment. But briefly, ladies and gentlemen, we have a new product back in stock that's been sold out for... 5 months. In fact, it's been sold out so long that I almost said just change the formula, but Dr. Group didn't want to do it. It is the ultimate cleanse of all sorts of different parasites, from bacteria right down to you name it. And it has dramatic effects. It has incredible reviews. It's back in stock. The statistics are clear. 9 out of 10 people are infested with harmful organisms like Hillary Clinton. I'm sorry, I won't get rid of her. I'm being sarcastic. Once these organisms have made it inside your body, they steal your nutrients and release toxic waste. It's time to start eliminating toxic and harmful organisms from your body. The worms and stuff crap inside you, folks. Our InfoWars Life Living Defense Harmful Organism Cleanser is now back in stock at InfoWarsLife.com. I almost discontinued this because it's so hard to get the ingredients and it's gone forever. So everything, we got to have everything past California standards, and it's almost impossible, and we get the only best organic. It's just, folks know what we get, 5 stars. Living Defense uses organic herbs and enzymes to help naturally cleanse harmful organisms from the body. Stock up and start cleansing now at InfoWarsLife.com before we sell out again. That's InfoWarsLife.com. Yeah, and we're really trying to up the production to be able to not run out. Here is Vic in Tucson, Arizona, says, Living Defense, this is done with deep cleanse, and neither had side effects. Easiest cleanse I've ever done with the ingredients of the product is terrific and well-priced. Thank you, Alex and crew. Here's one from Dan in Spring Hill, Florida. Living Defense is awesome. Taking Living Defense daily now has made a huge impact on my health and feeling of wellness. You have to try it for yourself. Yeah, it's also really good for you in a lot of other levels. Just go read all the ingredients. It's got the kitchen sink in it. So that's some of the exciting things that are happening right now. Secret 12 is a super high-quality organic form of absorbable vitamin B12. Most people can't absorb B12 in the stomach. It has to be absorbed through injections or in the mouth, preferably under the tongue. That's what this is for. It's 80% methylcobalamin, then it has 20% another form of vitamin B12 that helps absorb it. What is it? Acetylcobalamin? I'm probably pronouncing it wrong. Just go read why this is the ultimate formula from our research, InfoWarsLife.com, or call toll-free. 888-253-3139. And don't forget, we have a new system from Alexa Pure that is the Alexa Pure Breeze 4-stage incredible filter. Does 800 square feet to 99.99% with 4 different filters, different technologies, 4 different ones. It runs almost silent. Comparable units are up to $1,000. You can get some other decent ones for $400. It is, ladies and gentlemen, still on sale. I didn't just keep running the sale. I heard the ad running, and I guess our ad guy is at a conference. And so I'm like, wow, that special's supposed to be gone. Pull that ad, thinking that it wouldn't be on the shopping cart for 26% off out of the gates. But it's still extended because the special's not been taken down. So you know what? I'm extending it until next week. Boom. I don't even know if I'm authorized to do that, but I'm here, and train wrecks, we will turn into lemonade. Big, fat, giant lemons, they are now lemonade for you. I wonder why the sales of it were still so high. This unit is cheap at $300, incredibly cheap at $224 like it normally is. It's $180-something right now. InfoWarsStore.com. Out of the gates. only exclusively here. It's the same folks that make Alexa Pure Pro and all the great water filtration systems that you can get 10% off of with promo code WATER and get free shipping on orders $50 or more and get 10% off. We sign up for auto ship on things like Living Defense or things like X2 or things like Liver Shield. It's all there. InfoWarsLife.com is the nutraceuticals. InfoWarsStore.com is the umbrella site. InfoWarsHealth.com is the full line of amazing longevity products, nutraceuticals. And when you purchase it there, at the biggest discounts that are out there, we make a small amount of money off each sale and also helps fund the operation at InfoWarsHealth.com. Okay, shifting gears. We have had such a victory. We have the London Guardian. We have the London Independent. We have U.S. newspapers and publications and CNBC. Thanks to Drudge helping break the blockade 10 years ago, and of course InfoWars and others, we now have them going, okay, global elite are meeting setting policy for world government, and local governments are upset, and the public's upset, and is this legal? And yes, they're meeting, and our sources say that they're talking about carbon taxes, internet taxes, which is internet ID to control and track what you do and kick you off the web if they want. And it's this whole nightmare scenario. So this is such a gigantic victory that now people are saying, you know, the EU bureaucracy was set up by them and no one voted to enter it. And it's dictatorial. How did this ever happen? See, once you start talking about shadow groups that run the EU and the NAU, they set up that are now having politicians sign our sovereignty over to, it's the beginning of the end. See, the ultimate dictatorship has to be invisible, but we're shining light on it. Toto's pulling the curtain back. This is big, big, big. And who went to Bilderberg many times? Herr Hitlery. Who went when he was just an obscure governor? Oh, Bill Clinton. And moreover, there, the Germans come up to our reporters. They know about it. So to give us the latest on this, is Paul Joseph Watson, who got the Bilderberg Group list, got it out first, DrudgeReport.com linked to it, and we're still dominating coverage. I'm very proud of our crew. Paul, you're there, just a hop, skip, and a jump from where you normally live in London, but you're in Germany. Tell us what you've discovered there.
Well, getting in was interesting, Alex, because, of course, I came from Prague, flew to Prague from London, and then got the train from Prague into Dresden. Got a little bit of a light grilling by the German border police. They wanted to know where I'd come from, where I was going, what I was doing. Probably more invasive questions than some of the Syrian migrants would get coming into Germany.
They don't even allow screening of them. They admit that. Go ahead.
What was even more interesting, though, was getting in the taxi, talking to the taxi driver, and just driving past the train station here in Dresden. Because as I was getting in, the police were arresting migrants for drug dealing around the train station. They were actually putting them in the police car.
Oh, please, did you get video of that on your phone?
No, because I was speeding past in the taxi. But the taxi driver said that this is a huge problem recently. Tunisian drug dealers around the area, that's their turf. That's where they go. He said that the police are arresting them almost on a daily basis, but then they get out of jail the next day and they're back on the streets. So the very first conversation I had, I didn't even bring up the subject, and he started talking about how they brought in 5,000 of these migrants, about how the crime has risen in Germany. In fact, there's a report out of Reuters on Infowars.com right now, which says that 69,000 crimes have been attributed to migrants in the first quarter of 2016. But the spin, the lie, is that they say that's, quote, disproportionately low for migrants. But if you actually drill into the reports, the German crime statistics for the past year, there are 400,000 crimes committed by migrants. They're overrepresented in terms of their population by 2 to 1. So they're around.
Well, look at rape alone. Look at rape alone, Paul.
Yeah. Yeah, I brought that up as well. And he said that, you know, there's a big cover up regarding that, as we know. So this lie we've been told, I mean, obviously we've got the huge Brexit thing going on in the UK right now. Nigel Farage went on a debate show last night and merely brought up what happened in Cologne. Immediately the next day, in every single British newspaper, he was being attacked as a racist by the Archbishop, as a racist, simply for bringing attention to what happened in Cologne and saying, bringing in this number of people at such a pace, given the criminality that we've seen, might be a bit of a problem. He was castigated as a racist for doing so. So now the media is starting to admit that this is an issue, but they're blaming it on right-wingers. In fact, in the police report that they released here back in May, it was a couple of weeks ago now, they blamed the rise in crime on the German right wing committing thought crimes, you know, going on Facebook and, God forbid, criticizing their government's
migrant policy. Well, that's like the mayor of Cologne said it's the women's fault they're getting raped because they're too hot.
Yeah, and in fact, there was a report out of Norway a couple of weeks ago where they're seeing a similar rise in crime, and the media there blamed it on Nordic drinking culture. Like, there's never been drinking culture.
Look, this
in
is
Norway
an
before.
Absolute program of evil, and it's intensifying, and this is the breakdown of Europe into the Middle East. This is the implosion of the U.S. into Latin America. This is the world government. We're seeing the formation. This is what Peter Sutherland, that founded the EU, said it would be. The head of the EU then goes down to be the head of the migrant board, who advertises, opens the border, brings them in. Now, Paul, from my sources and relaying to you and your sources, we have the Bilderberg leak, secretive group to discuss Internet ID, global tax. Let's get to that. That's big.
Well, of course, they've been pushing this Internet ID in communist China for at least 10 years now. In fact, Lieberman came out and called for it, you know, 10 years ago now. This online ID where they can track dissent by linking it to a social credit score. Now, in China, they've started it off with one of the big corporations there, Alibaba, and the communist government is starting to adopt it. That's the second phase of it. And it links what people buy online, what comments they make on social media, to their credit score. So if they get downvoted by other loyal, obedient citizens, their credit score goes down. They have less privilege, less access to the internet. Of course, we see that on Reddit. The people who get upvoted more get more privilege.
And
when
that's what the EU,
comments.
That's what the EU proposal, which is the bureaucracy runs thing, just last week they proposed that and said, just like the Chinese model, they'll have that social score.
Exactly, because studies show that people read news articles on the internet and they don't necessarily believe the narrative in the actual article. In some cases, they go immediately to the comments and see what other people are saying. And because the comments are so drastically in favor of, you know, the kind of narratives that we're all about and against this dominant narrative that multiculturalism and diversity is working great, which it clearly isn't, they're afraid of that because people are reading the comments and getting their narrative from that rather than the spin being put out by the media. So that's why we've seen major websites shut down comment sections, and that's why they're moving now, as you said, with the EU. And Bilderberg is here this week to discuss the same thing, having this internet passport where you have to get de facto permission from the government to comment on social media. Obviously, it's not gone that far yet, but that's how they plan to introduce it, by saying, oh, it's so convenient. You're using different passwords for each different account. That's so messy. We're going to correlate that into a single internet passport so we can track everything.
Which will be biometrically accessed.
Yeah, and it's not happening right now, but that's what they want to move.
That's their admitted plan. That's why they're waging a war on cash. Now, Paul, tell us what else, because we're going to go to break in a moment. What else is on your front burner? What else you plan to cover? So let me tell you, I understand you're speeding by, you want to get somewhere, but man, if you just said pull over, got some of that on tape, done an interview, or bring the crew back to show, because they'll say those were Germans dealing drugs. Bet your bottom dollar.
No, they'll say they're right-wing thought criminals. Yeah, we're going to go back to the train station because there's a lot of activity around there. And as the taxi driver said, it's been a huge problem.
Well, you know, Rob Dew's not a Mr. Start a Fight guy, but he's tough. So I just want to see one of those punks try to go up and punch him and see him lay down like those Germans have been doing. They're going to get their head torn off.
But he said that the police just maintained a constant presence because it's so prolific, the drug dealing, that they're just sweeping them up every day but then releasing them. So we're going to go back there and take a look at what's happening.
Sure, that's like that guy that they arrested twice, robbing stores. They were in Germany. They arrested him a third time. Vigilantes come and take him to the police, and now they're arresting them. Robbing a store three times in one day. I mean, this government is working against you because it works for foreign globalists. We'll be back with Paul Watson from Dresden, Germany. I'm Alex Jones. All right, I've got Donald Trump clips coming up that are bombshell, and I'll give these at the start of the next hour. I mean, he really took the gloves off with Hillary, blast Hillary and a rigged system. He says he will be America's champion and will not let us down. We'll put America first. He points out he's gotten more votes than any other Republican ever. He points out that he welcomes all the new voters. Points out that he thrives on peace and isn't a warmonger. I mean, this is strong. Paul Watson, describe again where you are for TV viewers and radio listeners, and have Rob Dew or Josh Owens pan around for us a little bit as you're there in Dresden, Germany. covering the global secret elite meeting that for 40 years they made fun of people and said didn't exist, and that now they admit does exist and runs our new unelected super governments. Oh, by the way, their philosophy is eugenics. You might want to look into that if you're a new listener or viewer. Paul Watson.
Yeah, we're here in Dresden, Germany for the 2016 Bilderberg Conference. They've blocked off the outer perimeter to the Kempinski Hotel here. Obviously, our reporters got kicked out of the hotel earlier today, which Rob will tell you about. And we're here. There's not a massive police presence right now. Obviously, that's going to increase tomorrow when the attendees start arriving, which is usually around 11 in the morning to 12 midday. So that's when we're expecting the most activity. There'll be a big flurry of activity then. A couple of other things. There's a Bilderberg attendee called Peggy Noonan, who is a writer for the Wall Street Journal, who follows me on Twitter. So she must be a big fan of my YouTube videos. And I've...
No, she's a fan of you covering Bilderberg, because she's gone before.
Yeah, so I asked her out on a date. I asked her to go for a coffee in Dresden. Haven't heard back yet, so I'm looking forward to that if it happens. And the other thing is, Hillary Clinton's schedule is clear for the next couple of days. She's visited Bilderberg before. Obviously, that's unlikely, but she doesn't have any events over the next couple of days, so we'll watch out for that.
All right, Paul, I want to talk to or Josh Owen. I know you're busy filing reports. Great job. I hope you go back to migrant camps. I hope you're obviously going to fly a drone over those. I want to show these drug dealers and what's going on. And I know at these train stations, folks do try to attack people, so be careful. I know after Bilderberg's over, you guys are going to spend a few days going to Cologne and some other areas to document the no-go zones. But any other points you want to make?
Now, just the point on the leak that we got, which is the global tax. That's something they've pushed before. They want either a tax on the oil well, a tax on international financial transactions, or a green tax for flights. And that's kind of hypocritical.
And that'll be the start on all carbon. That's the carbon tax.
Yeah. Well, they're using massive amounts of energy just staying in this hotel for a few days. So Rob's going to talk more about that.
All right, Paul, great job. You go ahead and hand the baton over literally to Do, and then I'll spend a few minutes with Owens coming back here. Do, what else has happened in the last 24 hours? Oh, they're switching out right now. But again, this is real media, teleprompter free, folks. We're not playing games. We're exposing the criminals right now. The Legion of Doom meeting right behind Rob Do. If you're a TV viewer, you're a radio listener, Infowars.com/show to find the free feeds and find the limited edition. When these sell out, we're going to have a new edition of the Hillary for President shirt that I just ordered today. So these will sell out in the next few weeks. Hillary for President 2016, InfoWarsStore.com. And your purchase helps support the broadcast. We're going to come back with more with you, dude, but what else has happened in the last 24?
Well, last night when we got back to our hotel, we had this letter on the letterhead of the hotel, which I do have in my possession.
Oh, I forgot about and that being thrown out, yes.
Yeah, exactly. We hereby inform you that you have to be out by noon. There's no, you cannot stay any time past noon. And if you don't get your car out of the garage by noon, we're going to hold on to it. So they basically said they're going to steal your car and there's nothing you can do about it because the lovely globalists are coming and nothing can stand in their way. Yeah,
and the taxpayers are paying for the military to be there. And let's aim the camera down. You got to walk up to the, when we come back in 60 seconds, 70, we got to walk over and talk to the police at the checkpoint. Now, I know they're German police. Very polite to you mess with them and then, well, you know what happens. But we're going to find out what's going on. Of course, we had to teach the old Germans a little lesson, didn't we? We'll be right back. Stay with us. I'm Alex Jones. All right, we're evil Americans concerned about the EU signing secret treaties with the NAU and criminals in our country working with European criminals to overthrow our governments, destroy our free speech, open our borders up, make us pay for everybody. We're being conquered. 21st century warfare. How dare us prove secret meetings are going on? How dare us do our job and force the mainstream media to do it? And how dare Rob Do in Germany, in Dresden, is about to walk up and talk to the police? Rob Do, go ahead and describe what's behind you. You got the police there. Go ahead and go try to talk to them.
All right. So what we're at right now, there's concrete barriers, wrought iron gates, probably 20 to 30 policemen around this area. And it looks like the police are coming down the street now. It might be for some running. I think there's a running event going on. But, Alex, this morning when I was talking to the security and the people behind the counter at the desk, none of them would say Bilderberg. I even asked, I said, is it because of the Bilderberg event? Is that why we're getting kicked out? I don't know, sir. I don't know, sir. I know nothing. I know nothing. So let me ask these two gentlemen. Excuse me. Excuse me. Hey. No? Don't want to talk? We can't even ask you a question?
You're not even human.
Do you have a PIO, public information officer?
Bilderberg doesn't exist.
No one?
Notice, it doesn't exist still for those folks.
They don't want to talk to us. There's actually a race going on right now in the town of Dresden.
Just like Hillary stealing the delegates doesn't count.
Look at this. These people have no idea what's going on next to them. Just as we were watching tours going by this morning, as a tour would come by, they're locking everything down. I said, hey, do you know what's going on? No, I have no idea. They had no idea why the security was here. Well, it's a Bilderberg meeting. Oh, what's that? You need to go look it up. This is a secret meeting of your leaders who are creating an unelected combine to dictate your future. And you have no say in it, no matter what. These people, and you got these people running by during all this madness. It's totally crazy what's going on here in Dresden.
Well, the German people are great folks, and they're really awake, I've noticed. Yeah. But their governments are really evil, and it's just like our government's evil. You know, what happens if America gets in a war like Germany did and tens of millions of us die because we didn't do enough to stop what's coming down? What do you make? I don't know if you've heard this. They admit in even New York Daily News that a secret committee met with the Associated Press on Monday and told them the results of the election via the superdelegates. That's voter news services. That's how they've stolen elections before. But now it's being forced out in the open, and the media is acting like it's normal, dude.
Well, I was looking at the return results, and I think it was Montana, I'm not sure, where Bernie Sanders won the popular vote, and he still got less delegates. So they're just, once again, and I pointed this out three or four times, it's just ridiculous. It's just at any time he wins a race, and he won by like 8 or 9%. Like, he should have had more, at least three more delegates than Hillary Clinton, but he had one less than she did. So that's how it's going. Bernie supporters, that's what they're doing to you. They're taking your dreams. They're taking basically exactly what happened to the Ron Paul movement. Although they had so many people in that race in 2008, 2012, Ron Paul wasn't able to maintain momentum. But here it was just a two-person race. I think if Ron Paul would have been going against like Mitt Romney or John McCain, it would have been a totally different story if it had just been one-on-one. But people got to see that's what would have happened to Ron Paul. They would have been stealing delegates. They'd have been stealing the election just by a few percentage points because that's how they manipulate it. But yeah, the fact that they knew what the results were going to be with these superdelegates and people just let it go.
It's open, stolen election out in the open. Oh, let's go over here. The cop's talking to these people. He's talking to them like they're human. Run over there. He's going to run off. Walk over there. Watch. He'll run off.
Yeah.
And just say, hey, who's meeting inside? What is this meeting?
So you're going to talk to these guys, but you won't talk to me? You don't want to talk with me because I'm an evil American?
Because he's the press.
Hey, he laughed when I said evil American, so he doesn't think I'm an evil American. You need to look up the Bilderberg.
You do look like the dude, though, from Big Lebowski.
I do.
Ask those folks what he said. Ask the old folks.
What's that? Okay, Bilderberg is a meeting of 200 of the most powerful people in Western Europe, Canada, and the United States to get together. Well, so the King of the Netherlands is going to be here. Angela Merkel's ministers are going to be here. We don't know if the president is coming. But Obama. Hillary, well, yeah, Obama's probably not going to come, but Hillary Clinton might. She might show up. She went to a meeting in 2008 when they were going to decide whether it was going to be Obama or Clinton. Mm-hmm. But they meet here. And when you talk to, they won't even say Bilderberg. He won't say Bilderberg. He might have, but the people inside will not say Bilderberg. They're afraid. And so they're having this meeting in secret. And these are Germans, Austrians, Polish. Yeah, it's a secret meeting. They won't talk. You notice there's only alternative media here. Tomorrow, they're all going to be coming in.
Oh, this guy's going behind the curtain. Stay there, dude. I'm going to come back to you and Alex Newman. Stay with us. Alex Newman is an educator, and he writes for the New American Magazine, and he has dug through Obama's rural communities plan, also the rewilding plan, and then now they have this diversification plan, saying that money and wealth and also scientific know-how is fleeing to the suburbs or the countryside. Absolutely. You want to live in cities where they charge you $5,000 a month for a 250-square-foot apartment? That's the model. You don't get something smaller and then get a value. They screw you. It's how to get all your money. They want 90% tax. That's Agenda 21. That's what the robber barons want. They exempt themselves from the taxes. I have articles here today where McDonald's globally is getting countries to exempt it from taxes. And here's the issue. Everybody else that's in the country, their businesses don't. That's what the New World Order is. They write all these rules and regulations to put us in flypaper, and they're just flying around above us. I mean, and it's not just that. It's criminal laws they exempt themselves from. This is what world government is. So he's got a new article out on it, but there it is, out of the Financial Times of London. Russell serves up McDonald's secret exchanges with Grand Duchy to get tax breaks nobody else in the country gets to bring in their crap. How about more taxes on your garbage food? That's social engineering, so I don't want that. But I'm saying instead of you getting always the exemptions and then wondering why the place with a great hamburger next door is $4 more, it's because they've got to pay all the taxes, the Obamacare, and the rest of it. So we're going to go to Alex Newman in a moment, his story. UN adopts education plan to indoctrinate children in globalism. That's one article. And then we've got another one. The reason I wanted to get him on is about the situation with the zoning. If you guys can print me that article, where, oh, we're going to not make the countryside racist. That's like, oh, Germany, a town has 102 residents. They bring in 700, quote, Syrians who are really just invading from all over the world into Syria, into Turkey. I mean, it is just mind-blowing. Imagine 700 people in your town of 100, and you're supposed to pay for everything. So we're going to be talking to him while we talk to Rob Du and crew who are on the ground in Dresden, Germany, and we're just educating Germans who were walking up talking to the police saying, what is this? And they wouldn't tell him. So the man says, yeah, they won't tell us. You know, we're here. What is it? He goes, it's a secret global government conference with world leaders. And the guy's like, what? So let's go back to Rob Du to put bookends on that and then ride shotgun with us till the bottom of the hour. Dude, this is just getting crazy, isn't it?
Yeah, and that older couple, they were totally freaked out by what I told them. I wish we hadn't gone to break. I wish we would have skipped the break right then, because I was sitting there educating him, just going, this is what it is. These are the people. Because I'm like, you know, 200 of the most powerful people. Oh, who are they? Oh, the king of the Netherlands, the head of Google, you know, the editors at Bloomberg and The Economist, and also the Peter Thiel, who's a big investment banker. I just started naming off all these people that are coming here to basically dictate your future. And then I said, these people are total hypocrites. Inside, in the rooms, we couldn't get our air conditioning to work, okay, for 2 days. Luckily, it's nice, so we just opened the windows. They built a giant stage with a plastic frame on top, like a giant tent with its dome looking. And they're pumping in air conditioning into this dome because it's hot, because the sun's hitting it. It's inside the courtyard. You can't see it from here, but we shot a video on it this morning. Called it the location of the Bilderberg foam party found, because it looked like they have these hoses and they're going to like pump in foam at some point and run around and jiggle with each other or something disgusting like that. But they have giant vents and they're pumping in air conditioning into this thing while they're telling you you can't have air conditioning, and people don't get that. And it's really, it's just, they're total hypocrites. And the guy's like, yeah, you're right. We'll check it out. And he asked how to spell it. And then him and his wife walked off to enjoy their night. But, you know, they're walking around here. They're wondering what's going on. Why do they have these concrete pylons? Why do they have bomb-sniffing dogs? There's two cars over here with bomb-sniffing dogs that they've been bringing up into
the
room.
Well, Rob, I surmised, because I saw him talking to the cop, and then he came over and said, I don't know what this is, that the cop hadn't told him. Did you get a chance to ask him what the cops told him it was?
No, he was asking them what it was, and they said it was an event. They don't ever say what it is. And it's just like what happened with us inside and talking to the security outside. So they have Bilderberg security. They have the red lanyards, and they were walking around. They said, you got to move your car. And I said, why do we have to move our car? What's going on? Oh, nothing. Nothing's going on. Why do I have to move my car? You know, what's the big deal? So it's just, we're not going to tell you what's going on. Don't say the words Bilder and Berg together, because we'll totally freak out. The staff had a just conniption fit this morning when three other reporters, Luke and Dan Dix and Lauren Southern, stayed in their rooms. They kind of just stayed in their rooms after the noon o'clock hour. So we filmed them coming out, and, you know, they were just, these people were totally freaking out. They don't want to say anything because I guess they're afraid to lose their job, because, you know, once you lose your job anywhere in you know, Europe or the United States, well, you might not find another one, and then you're going to be destitute like those other people out there, you know, the poor and destitute of the world. So your only choice is to submit to these demons that are coming here and want to rule us like gods.
I've got two new articles. Swedish police excuse migrant rape, blame Nordic alcohol culture and ignorance. That's what was being mentioned earlier. That's from Breitbart.com. Here's another one. Obama making bid to diversify wealthy neighborhoods. But you read deeper, it is to bring in Agenda 21 in the countryside. And our guest has written an article about that. I want to bring him in about both these issues and tie it all together with Alex Newman of TheNewAmerican.com. I tell you, Alex, to actually see the shadow government being exposed. This is a huge victory. To see mainstream news have to report they're indeed in there making policy, this is a big victory. But now we've got to go the rest of the way. Give us your take on the leaked agenda that we have exclusively gotten for global taxes. We know that's already on the agenda, but we've confirmed it. Internet taxes to track the web, internet censorship. And do you stay with us and pop in anytime you'd like. But, Alex, just amazing to see their agenda coming from this little secret meeting every year. And then whatever they want to do from our sources ends up being the new policy just within a few weeks.
Thanks for having me, Alex. And it really is amazing how everything is coming out into the open now. You guys' coverage of Bilderberg has been awesome. I actually met some of your guys in Copenhagen covering Bilderberg a few years ago. And great work you guys are doing. And it's amazing to see how the Bilderberg is out in the open now. I did a quick search this morning for news on Bilderberg, and it's in all the big newspapers. So now they're talking about it. It's exposed. And it's thanks to the work of the alternative media, people like you guys, who are really out there doing the job that the media should have been doing and that you guys have been doing for many years. So it's amazing to see. Keep up the good work. And, you know, the agenda is really troubling now that it's coming out, you know, with the global taxes. They've been on this mission for a long time. But now, as people are waking up, now as the agenda comes out into the open, now is the time for humanity to stand up and say, no, we're not going to pay global taxes. No, we're not going to allow you to brainwash our children in government schools with, you know, UN globalism and spirituality. This is the kind of stuff they're talking about now. So, great work, and let's keep it up because we can still definitely
win. Sure. And I mean, to be clear, I'm not trying to say good work to you, good work to me or anything. I'm saying we're having success in the war. We're identifying the whole shadow apparatus. They fought so hard to keep it secret because it can't continue on having a secret dictatorial planetary program forever. We're going to have a debate about this.
That's right. And we're now coming at the time when this is going to be out in the open. You know, the tyranny could only be implemented under the radar for so long. Now it's starting to hit home. Now you're getting millions of, third world immigrants coming in under the guise of refugees. Now they're cranking down the screws with the global taxes and the carbon taxes and the shutting down the businesses and diversifying the neighborhoods and putting the globalism into the schools openly. So now that this is out in the open, you know, you really have to be a zombie to not understand what's happening. So now is when, how do they say, now is crunch time, right? Now we really need to get busy. Now everybody can see what's happening. They can't conceal it anymore. So now is the opportunity, I think.
Exactly. Let's be clear. When they send, these are real stories, a town of 700 Germans, they send 3,000. There's a metric I've noticed. You know, 700 Germans, 3,000 invaders. Okay, a town of 102, we send in 700. This is to erase those groups, take them over, and create an enclave that's state-funded where they then start pumping in more refugees. And I've noticed here, it's in the hundreds of thousands. They say it's in the thousands. It's in the hundreds of thousands. Just like Europe said it was in the hundreds of thousands, it was millions. And they are sending them to small towns of a few hundred. They'll send 100 Syrian refugees. They're taking over. They're setting up the breakup of the country. Alex, get into this whole rewilding after the break. Also, how they're trying to, quote, diversify the neighborhoods. What's behind that? But first, Rob Dew, your questions or comments for Alex Newman of the New American Magazine.
Well, I'll just tell it like it is, Alex, that we talked to this guy, Muhammad, who said basically they're given free housing and food and they're giving them spending money and they're told they can't do anything else. They have to sit around and do nothing. So you're just
they've got to learn to be wards of the state. They're being fashioned and then in a few years they'll become police officers after they've gone through the courses.
Well, either that or they're going to become jihadis because they're sitting around and they don't like the looks they're getting from the German people. They don't like how they're being treated by the people in the area. So they're getting resentment. And so that's just building inside of them. And I could feel it the way he was talking. He's like, they look at me funny. And then when I walked over there to talk to him, he was with a group of five other guys. They all looked at me like they wanted to kill me. They were like, I mean, they were pissed off. And they didn't want to talk to me at all. Only one guy did. And but he gave
me that
perspective.
Of course, he's like, I stay here. Everyone hate me, but it's mine now. Free stuff.
Exactly. Oh, yeah. He wasn't going to leave. So they're going to stay here for the free stuff. But then what's going to happen after that? What's going to happen after 1 year or 2 years that he's inside Germany and getting nothing or getting all this stuff, but not having to do anything for it?
Rob Dew, stay there. I'm going to come back.
A system of babies.
Absolutely. Rob Dew in Germany. We're talking to Alex Newman here in the U.S. I'm in the U.S. Alex, going out to break in 1 minute. What comes next after this? I mean, how does the political class think they're going to get away with this?
Well, you know, it's funny. You guys are at Bilderberg right now. They told us, Peter Sutherland, the Goldman Sachs guy, member of the Bilderberg Steering Committee for quite some time. Now he's the UN czar for mass migration. And he told us what's going on here. He said, we have to get rid of these old shibboleths, this national sovereignty, these borders. We're all just one big human family. So that's the plan. That's what they think they're going to do. They're going to flood the countries with people who have no conception of Western civilization because Western civilization is not compatible with globalism. And, you know, that's the agenda.
Now, I'm going to get Josh Owens on here in a moment and then get Paul Watson to pop back in with his take from Dresden, our three reporters there. But I don't see their whole project going too well, Alex Newman. I mean, if it's criminal, if it's illegitimate, if the EU never got voted on for these countries to join it, once the public learns about that, the numbers in the polls, like the British exit, the Brexit, only turns against the New World Order. I mean, aren't they in crisis? They always wanted to organize financial crisis in their own documents to bring in more globalism, more centralization, more power, more scarcity so we're poor with their thumb on us. But instead, people now know it's the globalist authoring this, whether it's Latin America or Europe or Africa or Asia. People are on fire with this awakening.
It's true. And, you know, we need to be there and keep providing the tools and the education that people need. But you're right. This is out in the open now. They're telling us what they're doing. And so now we have a role to come in and say, hey, we've been looking at this for years, for decades. This is what's going on. This is how we need to fight it and get involved with us. Do you want your country destroyed? Do you want your liberty taken away? Do you want your children brainwashed? And the answer for a regular person is absolutely not. So now, you know, we've been in this fight for so long. Now it's time for people all over the world to see what's going on and wake up and put a stop to it.
Absolutely. We're about to go to Josh Owens here. Again, this is the future of media. This is teleprompter free. This is unscripted. This is reality based. Just analysis of common sense history. And let's go to Josh Owens. Josh, just watching this unfold, being in Germany now 3 days, what is it like to actually witness this for yourself? I mean, you've seen a lot in your years here at InfoWars.
Yeah, well, just seeing the firsthand perspective is pretty unbelievable. I was expecting it when we came here. I was expecting to get some confrontations with people. I was expecting some people to be unhappy, especially that we were filming them, because apparently that's the worst thing in the world. But to actually see it in person, and you're right, I've seen a lot of things. We've been at Bundy Ranch. We were threatened at the NSA. Countless things. Ferguson. So it's not like the U.S. is exempt, and we see the things happening in the U.S. now. But what, when you're out at these migrant camps and all you're doing is talking to someone, and this whole group of self-appointed blue shirt security guys come and run towards you and start screaming at you.
And by the way, their body language was very, very aggressive and intimidating.
Absolutely. And that's the thing about being here in person. It doesn't convey always in video. And like I said a couple days ago on the show, I wish that I had unplugged Dew's mic so you could hear the guy that was beside me, because he was threatening me, telling me that he was going to delete the footage. I mean, this guy acted like he had more power than the thugs at the NSA when they screamed at us. It's completely ridiculous. These people are entitled. They think that they have the right to threaten
people. Yeah, you're at the gate to their immigrant facility. They're the last wave of illegals that the government's put in charge. And, you know, you got a right to defend yourself when someone puts their hands on you. Sure, that hit a big, strong right hook right in the side of the head.
Go ahead. Exactly. We were on a public street. We're on a public street, and we had this city official come up and say, well, we just don't want them to feel threatened. We don't want them to feel harassed. But it's okay if they go in train stations and rape women and
crap
sell
in the
drugs.
Pool.
Yeah, it's okay if they do that and come to our countries and do that.
Because it's about the government breaking the Germans, who already pay the most taxes in the world and keep living under it and at the highest production rates in the world. And it's not enough. You know, the government taught them not to have kids and die. But even as it strangles them and uses them to take over the world, and they bring in their replacements that are literally wear diapers. I mean, this is what we're talking about. You're supposed to just bow down to them as you're being strangled.
Exactly, and that's what's going to happen in this building back here. You're going to have politicians, policymakers, big businesses. That's what they're going to be talking about. They're going to be talking about how to continue this migrant invasion, how to carry it over to the U.S. because Europe is collapsing with the migrants everywhere flooding the streets. Right now, we're in Dresden, so it's not as bad here. It's more of a conservative area. But in Munich, in Cologne, we see the news stories. We see the women getting raped by groups of people. We see people getting beaten in the streets. It's not we can't debate it because we see that it's happening. People see, we live in a time period now where all people have to do is hold this up and film what's going on. And so we see it firsthand. We might not be there, but we see what's happening. And it's
that's right. And you're there documenting it, and people can get your video reports unfiltered right there at Infowars.com, PrisonPlanet.com, and on the nightly news, 7 o'clock Central, weeknights, and of course here with Infowars Live, 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. Central Standard Time. I'm going to come back to Watson briefly here at the end of the break, but I want to go back to Alex Newman now for the balance of the time, but try to get Watson set up here in a few minutes to pop in with some final comments. Going back to Alex Newman of New American Magazine, let's get into their agenda. Let's get into this movement you've written about where they're going to spend tens of billions a year, and they're billing it as making the suburbs not be racist or rich neighborhoods not be racist. But when you really read, it's about setting up federal nodes in the rural areas.
It is. You know, I think there's a few components to this agenda. One of the key ones is essentially ignoring state borders, ignoring local government, city government, county government, usurping control of those and turning it into just an apparatus of the federal government. And that's what's happening here. They're using these multi-billion dollar slush funds. They have these huge pots of money that the GOP Congress keeps handing over to the Obama administration. And what they do is they say, all right, you local governments, you guys are taking money from us, so now you need to submit to our regulations.
Oh, I forgot. That's your other article yesterday. That's right. The GOP even has given Obama more money than he wanted for this. So they're helping run the whole thing to pay to bring immigrants, illegals, poor people, prisoners, criminals into these 10-story buildings they're building outside Austin and other areas you name it. I forget the town. Elgin. And then they admit it's Agenda 21 UN, and they just bring in prisoners and criminals and people right into the middle of your little town and just take over. Sorry.
That's right, and that's exactly what they have planned. They're collecting all of this data. They're going to look at the racial makeup, the income makeup of every neighborhood, every town, every zip code, and if there's not enough of certain race in this community, they're going to move some in. If there's not enough poor people in this wealthy middle-class community, we're going to build some housing projects there. We're going to have to rezone everything to conform with these international standards that are coming down the pike. And, it's very clear that this is not just a national agenda. This is not just the Obama administration. This is the implementation of international agreements, many of which, of course, the Senate has not even ratified. But, it's out in the open now. It's in your face. They are implementing these international agreements, Sustainable Development, Agenda 21. Now they have the UN Agenda 2030, where they're basically going to just come out in the open with the global governance. They're going to take over education. They want health care. They want, housing policy. They want the oceans. They want natural resources. They want national income redistribution. They want international wealth redistribution. They want common ownership of all resources. And this is all right in the document. Go to any search engine, type in Agenda 2030, look it up. It's right there. And now we see that this is what the Obama administration is implementing here.
They're now going into the next phase. Spend a minute on Agenda 2030, the next phase of the Rio plan.
Sure. There's 17 goals in this Agenda 2030, and there's something like 169, sub-goals, specific targets that they want to achieve. And I really cannot emphasize enough, people need to go out there and read this. They're just telling you flat out, we're going to build a global government. It's going to redistribute your wealth. And of course, they say we're going to redistribute wealth. They're not talking about the multi-billionaires that are kind of behind the scenes pulling the strings here. They're talking about you, right? Middle class.
That's right. You're going to pay for it. Alex, we got to get you up for a full hour in the near future to go through the documents, to go through each section of this and really educate people with an emergency warning. But our reporters are, again, on the ground with the people that created this whole plan, our meeting. Thank you so much, Alex Newman. Great job. Now, going back to Paul Joseph Watson in Dresden, we got 2 minutes to break. Paul, just looking at this plan to resettle the whole world with different groups of people controlled by the globalists, what do you make of this?
Well, it's all about turning everything upside down and creating it from anew. I mean, that's the last passage of the Communist Manifesto. They have to break everything down, whether it's good or bad, to build it up again. So that's what they're doing with the migrant issue. There's another tidbit, which is a journalist who is attending Bilderberg, Megan McArdle, who is a mainstream media journalist. Again, I messaged her on Twitter last night and said, you're a mainstream media journalist. This is the biggest scoop you could possibly have in your entire career. You're meeting with 120 of the most influential people on the planet. Are you going to report on it? This was her response. Oh, splendid. The anti-Semites have discovered me. So she just basically screamed, you're racist, simply for even asking.
That's all they got. She's meeting with royalty, world leaders, people that control trillions, and you're just a reporter that reaches millions of people a day. You say it's on Drudge Report, all over the news. You've been on CBS TV, all of it. And she just says, yeah, you're anti-Semitic.
You're racist just for asking the question. Then there's an NBC foreign affairs correspondent who is also attending, who I tweeted out last night. He's going to be here. He's not going to report on it. This could potentially make some of these journalists' careers. They're going to stay absolutely silent.
They're being brought in to prove that they'll be managers later. They're not there to be journalists. They're there to learn the conspiracy and show they'll keep their mouth shut. Great job, Paul. Big reports being filed as we speak at Infowars.com. You are kicking butt. Amazing. This is true journalism. We'll be back with Roger Stone with what he called deep intrigue when I talk to him at 2:15 a.m. It is unprecedented. For a long time. Bernie Sanders won. For a long time. More states and more delegates than Hillary, but the superdelegates just met with the Associated Press the day before the California primary and these other five states and just decided to give it all to Hillary. And even the New York Daily News, extremely liberal, came out and said, this is election fraud. This has been stolen. The Republicans tried to do this with Trump, but had to back down, at least so far. They tried to sell the idea, of course your vote doesn't count, but with Hillary, it's worked. But now they're saying the Bernie people are terrorists and are evil, and the Associated Press is warning their reporters to look out for the Bernie people because the AP up at the top with Voter News Services under a new name runs the show. So they've got to be watched very closely in the general election going up against Trump. They're now selling the idea that he's going to lose and lose big time so that when they steal the election, we accept it. But Roger Stone and I and many others understood what was happening a year ago and began to beat the drum that they'd try to steal it with the broker convention. People said that would never happen. They tried it. They've backed off. You have to first admit something's happening, like there's Bilderberg meeting. Oh, nothing like that exists. I had the New York Times 8 years ago say that it didn't exist and that I was in Virginia and that I was mentally ill and was schizophrenic and that I wasn't being followed by black sedans and wasn't thrown out of the hotel, even though it was all on tape. 8 years later, they got to admit it's real. They still say we're crazy for covering it. I want to play a short clip and then go to Roger Stone, who wasn't even scheduled today, but I saw a late night tweet from like 2 a.m. I was up, hit him back and said, and he's, well, there's a lot of intrigue. And so, yes, I'll pop in. He's going to pop in for just like 10 minutes. But first, I've got to start getting to these Donald Trump clips. Trump blast Hillary and rigged system. This is how he'll defeat him. Exposing they plan to steal it now is the only way, folks. He's going to destroy her in the debates, you name it, in my view. We'll ask Stone. We haven't talked yet. I don't know if he thinks my view's accurate, but we'll talk to him in a moment and get the quote, heavy intrigue in New Yorker, what the big news is. I don't know yet either. But first, let's go to the short clip.
There's one thing we all have learned. We can't fix the rigged system by relying on very, and I mean this so, so strongly, on the very people who rigged it. And they rigged it. And do not ever think anything differently. We can't solve our problems by counting on the politicians who created our problems. The Clintons have turned the politics of personal enrichment into an art form for themselves. They've made hundreds of millions of dollars selling access, selling favors, selling government contracts, and I mean hundreds of millions of dollars. Secretary Clinton even did all of the work on a totally illegal private server, something that how she's getting away with this, folks, nobody understands. Designed to keep her corrupt dealings out of the public record, putting the security of the entire country at risk, and a president in a corrupt system is totally protecting her. Not right. I am going to give a major speech on probably Monday of next week, and we're going to be discussing all of the things that have taken place with the Clintons. I think you're going to find it very informative and very, very interesting.
They're creating a master dossier. I know that's separate from Stone. From the Inquirer and Larry Nichols. And others.
I wonder if the press will want to attend. Who knows?
I love this guy. He's
Hillary
for real.
Clinton turned the State Department into a private hedge fund. The Russians, the Saudis, the Chinese all gave money to Bill and Hillary and got favorable treatment in return. Yes, It's a sad day in America when foreign governments with deep pockets have more influence in our own country than our great citizens.
This man did this as he won the historic primaries and got more votes than any Republican ever has. This is unprecedented. Believe me, he would not be working for them as a shill and saying this, because this damage to them is irrevocable. He is risking his life, and I have never seen gigantic elephant huevos anywhere near this size by somebody at this level. This is true manliness. Even though he's not perfect, I don't care. I'm all in for Donald Trump. I admire this guy. I tentatively started supporting him a year ago because I knew Hillary was pure evil. I'm so proud I made the right choice. My gut said, do it. Don't just sit back and, oh, both are bad and, you know, act like I'm all high and mighty. I am all in. But I'm telling you, folks, it is a death battle. This is so hardcore. Roger Stone, the latest, just bang, bam, bam. And I got a lot to talk about. What to expect next, where we're going, what the real numbers are. The Sanders people, they just got robbed. They admit that. Even a lot of liberal media is admitting it. How does Trump reach out and say, look, they're trying to steal it from me and him. Come to the guy the establishment hates, Goldman Sachs, the big money. They're all against me. Don't be idiots. Hillary's a fascist warmonger. Roger Stone, what do we do?
Well, first of all, Alex, pardon me if I have kind of a Cheshire grin over that performance by Trump, but I'm really happy because he's back on offense. He is breaking through because the mainstream media coverage, even of the Clinton financial crimes, has been inadequate, with the one exception of the New York Times, which has been exceptional. The mainstream media has been disinterested in the biggest two thieves since Bonnie and Clyde. And Trump is going to lay this out chapter and verse for the American people. It is one of Hillary's greatest vulnerabilities. It goes beyond just greed, and that's the issue. I think that's the key word, the epic greed of the Clintons. They've also put our national interests at risk, selling military secrets
delivery systems
to the Chinese through Loral, in this case, trading millions of dollars with the Russians and the Chinese and the Saudis, as Trump said. So I was very glad to see Trump pivot. I think Trump University is behind us. Now, even that is an outrage, because I now know more than the last time I was with you, Alex. Laureate Education is a multi-billion dollar Wall Street scam in which Bill took $16 million in fees. We don't know what he took in stock options because it's never been disclosed. And shortly thereafter, Hillary laid $150 million in federal money on Laureate Education, a failing chain of schools.
Sure, sure. I mean, their program is to be totally criminal to a level where they're interconnected so they can never go down. His Skype just went down, so that's why I'm interrupting here. And ladies and gentlemen, this is just so over the top. Our audience knows about all this corruption, though. And then we now know what I said weeks ago has been confirmed. The judge has connected all these La Raza groups, head some of them up. The media thinks you're so dumb. They go, oh, the La Raza Lawyer Guild has no connection to La Raza. It runs it. It created it. And again, hey, white supremacists want to be in those groups. Mexican supremacists want to be in these groups. The white supremacists think their group's good, too. People in La Raza think they're good. Folks have to stand up against this. We're going to get his Skype reconnected. We're getting back on phone. You want to go? His number right here, we can just call him right now. And I know, you don't have to even pull it out of the computer. We can just do it that way. But I want to talk about exactly, I know Stone's been advising Trump to be more aggressive. I know Trump's creating dossiers. That's what Nichols wanted to talk about yesterday. He's talking to him. They're vetting everything to really go whole hog against the Clintons. And I would go after him on Fast and Furious because they act like she's not involved in that. She ran that out of the State Department. And that's what Fast and Furious really was arms to Al-Qaeda and ISIS. And that's how Benghazi and Fast and Furious, with the Mexican gun running from the U.S. into Mexico, that's how they connect, because the gun running was only a cover to blame the Second Amendment. But that was an overall cover for a larger mission that was to get guns to Al-Qaeda and ISIS, which is anything the globalists do always has these multifacets. I'll call him. We've got Stone is back on phone. Okay, we have him back. Roger, good to have you back with us, my friend. Go ahead.
So, Alex, I would confess to be exhausted. As you know, I got to New York earlier this week. So I really think that that this new initiative by Trump puts him on offense, because this race is not about Donald Trump. He hasn't been running the country for 30 years, and he hasn't been running it as a continuation. So this is a referendum on Hillary. It must be. There are two, I think, cornerstones in this fight, two books that every American needs to read. One is Clinton Cash by Peter Schweitzer, which is a masterpiece showing how the Clintons are epically greedy and how they have gamed the system to line their pockets. And then, of course, there is the Clintons' War on Women, which outlines Hillary's epic abuse of Bill's sexual assault victims.
And that's your book, available at InfoWarsStore.com. Let me just digress with my questions, because I know you're way above me politically at understanding all this, but from a lay perspective, I have the New York Daily News, Politico and others admitting that Hillary stole this from Sanders and he was the real guy and the superdelegates robbed him. Don't we make a big deal out of that and reach out to the third of the Sanders people that you talked about who aren't total communist idiots and say, come on, go for Trump? Isn't that the big drive? If Trump came out and said, hey, Sanders got robbed, they're trying to rob me, go with me.
He actually said it last night. I think the exact quote is, to those Bernie Sanders systems who believe the nomination was rigged by superdelegates, we welcome you with open arms. Now, he said this right after he made the point that both he and Sanders oppose the globalist trade deals like NAFTA and TPP that have destroyed the American job market. And we know that he and Bernie Sanders are both non-interventionists, not neocons, as Hillary Clinton is. So I think there's a real opportunity there. That is why the Soros crowd is trying to smear Trump as a bigot and a racist, because those left-leaning votes will go to Trump if they don't disqualify Trump by smearing him.
Man, I just hope some of the liberals aren't idiots. I mean, how obvious is this, that the whole power structure hates Trump?
Well, look, there was a lot of piling on last week, because we got sidetracked in the ridiculousness of the Trump University case. This is a political case. This is a peanut compared to the multi-million dollar theft in the for-profit education.
And so Trump only took the bait in that he debated that instead of ignoring it and moving on, even though he's right about the judge, it's a side trail.
He's right about the entire thing, but I am of the theory that anytime Trump is not talking about Hillary Clinton's failed record, her abuse of women, or her corruption, or her incompetence, or her lying, and that he isn't talking about trade and immigration and our ridiculous fiscal situation and our broken.
I totally agree. So let me try to influence Trump right now, because I know, I mean, obviously he has his people out there watching talk to him. My listeners talk to him. You talk to him. I've talked to him before here on air. What about the fact that I see him talk about Benghazi, but not Fast and Furious? She ran that through the State Department. That was really gun running to Mexico. This has been proven now. Judicial Watch proved it. We had it before it was even in Judicial Watch. And guns are being sent to Al-Qaeda and ISIS. I think he should tie Benghazi and that together, and then she's done. Once you tie it to that, that ties the guns in, her coming after the guns, with giving guns to Al-Qaeda. She sent guns to Al-Qaeda and ISIS while trying to get our guns. I mean, boom. I think that's a great idea.
Well, I agree with Alex. It's only June, and we have a long campaign ahead of us. It's not like there is a lack of material when it comes to the incompetence or the treachery of the Clintons. These issues will be spelled out one by one.
Sure. Let's talk about some private stuff. What a tiger you are. I was there when, you know, you got the word that your mom wasn't probably going to make it, was about to go on morphine, and you said, this will be the last time I probably talked to her. You went and talked to her, and then sure enough, you were right about that. And here you are still fighting hard. It's funny, we usually wear suits or sports jackets. I'm wearing a blue shirt. You're wearing a blue shirt today. And when you were on the show on Skype, so I guess you're kind of in battle mode, but kind of relaxing a little bit. So I know you've been through a lot, my friend.
Well, first of all, I want to thank you, Alex, and everybody there at InfoWars for the beautiful flowers you sent in honor of my mother.
You bet.
You know, if you knew Olivia Soprano, you knew my mother. Tough, Sicilian, opinionated, determined, a patriot, and the saddest thing about her passing is it will be one less vote for Donald Trump. So we miss her, but she went down fighting, and I thank the literally thousands of people from InfoWars or from Twitter or from Facebook who sent me their condolences. It has meant a great deal to Mrs. Stone and I.
So, sure, you didn't really make it public. I kind of did without your permission, so I'm sorry if that was a problem, but I just want to talk about behind the scenes. you know, you talking to your mom for the last time and then coming in here and, you know, doing those interviews on Saturday?
Well, the truth is, Alex, when I'm writing, I don't wear a suit. I know a lot of people think I wear a suit to bed, that I wear a suit every day. But now I am working on a number of issue memos. I've written a terrific piece on Huma Abedin for Breitbart, which will be posted momentarily.
Oh, Hillary's girlfriend?
Well, I'm more concerned about the fact that...
The Muslim connection?
Yes, she's seen all of the...
Yeah, I don't care if Hillary's got two or three girlfriends. The issue is this woman works for Iran, basically, right?
Well, I think she works for the Saudis. And one of the things that I learned was that prior to her either hooking up with the Clintons, she buys a very expensive home in the Washington suburbs, and the handbags that she's carrying go for about $1,500 a piece. Her parents are academics. She has an enormous amount of money, which is a trademark of a spy, interestingly enough. She edits radical Muslim journals in college. Her family is tied to groups that are tied to bin Laden. I lay it all out for Breitbart. Now, the last person to do this was a reporter at Vanity Fair. Of course, he was savagely attacked by Media Matters for America. I found the Media Matters for America piece on Huma. 22 lies, falsehoods, complete obfuscations of the truth. So I think it should be untruthfulness matters for the folks over at MMFA.
Sure, I knew she was connected to the Saudis, but also to the Iranians. I mean, this lady just off the chart, as a spy. I mean, the evidence pointing towards it. And then Hillary accidentally for years with this server saying put secret stuff. She knows everything she's doing is being watched. It sounds to me like it's instead of dropping the package under the park seat to the Russians or the Chinese or everybody, she just does it openly on the damn server and then gets money in her foundation.
The biggest problem, though, is that one of the most notable things is that Huma is the only person in the State Department to receive a special waiver that allowed her to not only get a full-time salary at State at the highest level, but also to be paid by Teneo Strategies, the same place where Ed Rollins, who claims he's running a pro-Trump super PAC, works at a Clinton-connected lobbying entity, while she's triple-dipping at the Clinton Foundation. At the same time, she and Cheryl Mills are the two women who go through all of Hillary's emails and decide what we can see and what we can't see. Now, since we know that there's classified and top secret information in the emails, Huma, who's most likely a spy for a foreign government, has had full access to all that classified material. As an American, I find that troubling.
Well, I'm just speechless at this point, Roger Stone. How is the power elite? I know there's different elites and different combines, but they all meet, you know, like the mafia, and decide which way to go, and sometimes have wars if they don't. How do the Clintons just get away with anything and everything, and so flagrant? She looks completely insane on television. She has more baggage than a baggage train, more skeletons than the biggest mausoleum on the earth, than the catacombs of Rome. I mean, I just don't get it. They're going to really put this woman in for 4 to 8 years who literally beats up men and chews the carpet? She's so hateful. And she looks like she's about to die. I mean, what is the elite thinking? What does she have on them?
Well, I think that they unfortunately are trapped in the past. It was definitely much easier to conceal their crimes and what they were really like as people when we only had 3 television networks and a handful of national newspapers, the good old 80s. So if the Washington Post caught on to their corruption or heard from a Secret Service agent that Hillary had thrown a marble ashtray at Bill and grazed his cheek, that story could be suppressed. Today, those stories can't be suppressed. And I just don't think the Clintons understood that we are now going to re-adjudicate all of their greatest hits. Travelgate, Vince Foster, Filegate, the Mark Rich pardons, Monica Lewinsky.
Fast and Furious, Obamacare was her brainchild. Everything is her, everything, this woman squatting Libya on us.
Libya, Benghazi, but the overthrow of Gaddafi and the fact that women in Libya have been put back 200 years.
Sure. You're here, listen, you're here covering topics and info. You know my audience is one of the most informed out there, but they love hearing the facts to be able to tell others. But they know it. What about a little bit of, not inside baseball, but Trump looks totally energized, the courage he's got, he's super smart, the gloves are off, there's bare knuckles on now. I know you are in New York. I mean, this is just an amazing time. What else can you tell us just about this phenomenon and where it's going and other tidbits?
Well, as we've discussed on the show a number of times, Trump used a communications-based strategy to win the nomination, and it turned out to be brilliant. The campaign is now struggling to build the kind of organization, guerrilla as it may be, to contend. But we are late in some areas. For example, coalition building. Greeks for Trump, dentists for Trump, lawyers for Trump, airline pilots for Trump, Irish Americans for Trump, evangelical Christians.
Latinos for Trump.
These groups, there's so much grassroots enthusiasm. In many cases, when activists just couldn't wait for the campaign anymore to name a coordinator and put it together, they've gone out to do it themselves. There is a very broad-reaching Women for Trump organization in the works. So we are getting the grassroots late. When I say we, the Trump supporters. But I think the campaign is making strides finally to get organized.
Sure. What a tragedy to have Hillary supposedly representing the ascension of women. I mean, what a joke. This is horrible. I wouldn't want her representing me.
Yeah, as I said the other day, glass ceiling my ass. This woman is privileged. She is abusive. She is a domestic violator. She is
she's been running the country pretty much for 20 years. We've been living under her policies.
But she lectures us about domestic violence. She lectures us against violence against women and rape when she's a domestic violator, when she has
incredible
punched, scratched, and thrown things at Bill and multiple Secret Service agents. Not
sure,
one.
It's all coming out. So let me ask you this. Two quick ones. I want to let you go, and I appreciate your time. Can you get into any of the intrigue in New York, or is that all inside campaign stuff?
Well, what I refer to is the many moving pieces it takes for a monolith like this to shift. And Trump moved off of the Trump University issue and on to this offensive issue at a key time. Alex, I have to go, so I appreciate being with you.
All right, thank you. Roger Stone at StoneZone.com. Talk to you soon. Yeah, he was only supposed to be on for like 10 minutes. You hear the next call coming in. I tell you, that guy is a maniac. He works like 18 hours a day. No wonder he's been out there for so long. And he's been a pretty big insider, but for 15 years, he's been exposing the New World Order. And I like Roger Stone. He's a friend of mine now. I really like him. You know, I'm kind of bored hanging out with most people. You know what I mean? I don't go to all parties, or even Hollywood stuff's boring. But characters like Roger Stone, that's interesting. Wow. We've got a bunch of other guests coming up and a bunch of news and a bunch of Donald Trump clips I haven't gotten to. They just get better and better. But before I tell you what's coming up next, our reporters obviously that witnessed what happened out in California and more. Just briefly, Hillary for President shirts. We had one variant that also helps fund the whole show, so it's a win-win, that I said was going to be a collector's item, and it was. So we stopped making that one and made some changes to it because it was so popular. When this new variant sells out, we have a limited amount. It's a 4.9 star review, men and women style shirt, unisex. We will come out with a new version that is pretty much the same, just has on the right arm, Infowars.com. So when this sells out, it's gone. I've told the crew we're not making this anymore. A new design is coming out that's pretty much the same. It just says Infowars.com on the right shoulder in red. And on the back, it says Legalize Freedom, Infowars.com in white. I'm going to have that changed to white. And on the arm, it's going to be red. And that is the rest of the story. If you want to support the broadcast and get a great shirt to meet like-minded people and go to different rallies and stuff, this is the shirt. I'm wearing it today. Infowarsstore.com. This version says Hillary for President 2016 till the end of time. You can also call toll-free if you'd like the shirt to give it to your grandchildren, your husband, your wife, your boss, your crew, your coworkers, your neighbors. 888-253-3139, 888-253-3139. And Ancient Defense is back in stock, a great product that we have. And then also Living Defense, and that's something we've been out of for almost 5-6 months. Only had it in once. It's got so many ingredients, and to have the highest quality, have it test totally clean and pure, we just can't make stuff sometimes really at the highest standards. That's how this works. The planet's so contaminated. It's so expensive to test these, but it's it should be like $80. It's $34.95. Oh, I forgot to add, it's a discount. It's a huge bottle. In fact, I asked someone to bring me a bottle earlier. Could somebody bring me a bottle so I can wave it around maybe? Yeah, well, c'est la vie, whatever. Again, I'm like in Hitler's bunker here. Great crew, just not enough people. So Living Defense, available at InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsLife.com. Takes you right to the subpage. It is a big bottle with a whole bunch of caplets in it. And I just want to encourage everyone to go to InfoWarsStore.com. And bottom line, this will kick out the parasites, you name it. It's so good for you. It supports the broadcast, so you can't lose. And, of course, you can cut to me here with a wide shot for TV viewers. Has 120 capsules. They're horse pills. Dietary supplement. It's in powder form for better absorption. And it's to knock out harmful organisms, harmful organism cleansing. And it is just an amazing product. I never knew it would be our per capita bestseller. We only had it in once, sold out in 2 days, and now it's back. And I just have really tried to ramp up production, but who knows? Bottom line, support the broadcast, support your own health, knock out those bad guys. We got, you know, Hillary is the parasite, George Soros, but those are the big giant ones. Well, we also have the little teensy weensy little baby ones, you know, in there having a good time. And all other organisms, you know, deer go up, eat certain plants that help them get detoxified. It's available at InfoWarsLife.com. You know, I've had a few Democrats I'm friends with who kind of secretly agree with me and know what's going on, but they're in politics, so they go along with it. So alone, so alone. But they're funny folks, interesting. I've known them a long time, so I still associate with them occasionally. And they call up laughing at me and stuff. Oh, Hillary's winning. Oh, Hillary. And I tell them, I say, you have any idea how successful I'm going to be if Hillary gets into office versus Donald Trump? Because these people are all going with her from a sociopathic perspective. They're not sociopaths, but they can get in that mindset. I've bet on Donald Trump. He gets in and doesn't deliver or die trying, I'm going to have some problems. But I can't just sit here and think about having a perfect record and playing it safe, okay? In a time in history like this, I got to get aggressive. Everybody knows when Democrats are in office, talk radio, libertarian media only grows. And okay, we'll be looking probably at layoffs around here if Donald Trump gets in. But I'm fighting as hard as I can to get Trump in. I'd love to be able to have this country so free I could stop doing it. Of course, that'll never happen. But, I mean, really, I wouldn't be just risking my life and doing all this to fight these people. I mean, you think I want to go to Cleveland and all these places? Really? No. They want to go up against the New World Order? These people are killers. But I'm a man, and I'm doing it. Because I won't back down. I'll stand my ground. We got that in bumper music somewhere. I never hear it played. Let's go ahead and look. I got a bunch of Trump clips coming in the next segment and some guests, but I'm going to go ahead and play this one more time. It's so powerful. Donald Trump blasts Hillary and the rigging. I'm going to get to that next. But first, I want to play Donald Trump where he absolutely destroys the rig system and how corrupt she is. Let's play that clip one more time. It's so powerful.
There's one thing we all have learned. We can't fix the rigged system by relying on and I mean this so, so strongly, on the very people who rigged it. And they rigged it. And do not ever think anything differently. We can't solve our problems by counting on the politicians who created our problems. The Clintons have turned the politics of personal enrichment into an art form for themselves.
That's courage. That's a man right there. This is hardcore.
They've made hundreds of millions of dollars selling access, selling favors, selling government contracts. And I mean hundreds of millions of dollars. Secretary Clinton even did all of the work on a totally illegal private server.
Right, take a tour.
Something that how she's getting away with this, folks, nobody understands. Designed to keep her corrupt dealings out of the public record, putting the security of the entire country at risk, and a president in a corrupt system is totally protecting her. Not right. I am going to give a major speech on probably Monday of next week.
Get ready.
And we're going to be discussing all of the things that have taken place.
Oh, we got to get Nichols on.
You're going to find it very informative.
Because we communicate with Trump through Nichols, and he had to communicate with him yesterday. And so we need to get Nichols on tomorrow. I shouldn't have moved him yesterday, but stay there. Stay there. I knew about the speech on Monday from Nichols. Actually, Sunday from Nichols. He told me this big speech was coming up, and he was working with them, but it obviously doesn't want to be interfaced openly. They'll communicate through this portal. Let's get Nichols on tomorrow. We'll be back. Before I go to our guest with us at the bottom of the hour, then we have Leanne McAdoo, Joe Biggs, and others who did an incredible job last night covering Hillary stealing the election on the West Coast. Dr. Grubbs will be joining us, popping in via video Skype from his medical offices. But before we do that, I've got some extremely powerful Trump clips I haven't gotten to. I played the one twice where he just says they're total criminals, they've rigged everything. We're going to play a clip where he says they've defeated the rigged system so far. Yeah, Sanders didn't. But first, he talks about America first. This is what they call racist and evil. All the communist Chinese that killed, you know, 84 million of their own people under Mao and tens of millions since and have execution vans. And, oh, they're going to lecture us. And the Saudi Arabians who head up the UN Human Rights Board. And there's news on that today where they kill little kids. So that's getting covered. All of this craziness is here. All of this is happening and unfolding, and this is another outrage when he says the great evil. No, it's not mother or father, those words being banned, or male or female bathrooms. No, no, no. It's America first. Why, that the country might actually be for the country, not a bunch of foreign interests that came in and took it over. Let us play the blasphemy, the heresy. Let us play the anathema. Let us play the black magic to the New World Order. The inversion of their system you're about to hear out of the heretic's mouth, according to them, Donald J. Trump.
On foreign policy, we will never enter into any conflict unless it makes us safer as a nation. It has to make us safer as a nation. This is.
This is the opposite
of Hillary's foreign policy, which invaded Libya, destabilized Iraq, unleashed ISIS, and threw Syria into chaos and created the mass migration, which is wreaking havoc all over the world. And while putting Iran on the path to nuclear weapons and making them a dominant power in the Middle East. And they are dominant, and we have made them that way, folks. We have made them that way.
And then
better hope I'm president.
And then they call him anti-Semitic because he doesn't want to give Israel's enemies nuclear weapons. Our reporters are there via Twitter asking reporters that are at Bilderberg, allowed in, three of them, hey, talk to us. They go, I don't talk to anti-Semites. Well, what? It's just like, oh, you don't like Obamacare? You're racist. Oh, you don't like a judge, part of a race-based group, La Raza, you know, to rule on Trump when his law firm heads up a boycott against Trump? Why didn't Trump say, this guy's law firm heads up a boycott of me, he should recuse himself? It's just I actually like the fact he's like a bull in a china shop, but he opens up for him. But that's the good thing. He doesn't care. So you know what? I like it. I like it. You look at Trump, he hires more Hispanic people on average into management positions and women than any other major chain like he owns. Look it up. They've done stories. But he won't even defend himself. He doesn't care because he's such an animal. And I love it. It takes an animal to get up there and say Hillary's a total criminal and go over evidence of it. I mean, he knows she's a murdering criminal. She knows she's a major mob boss. So let's go ahead and go to this next clip here. Turned down Gingrich's $200 million that Adelson offered. Told you that was happening. Gingrich came out against him. Told you we've got the zeitgeist, and not just through Stone. I'll tell you, Nichols, I already believe Nichols, but his credibility went way up with what he told me this weekend. And I'm still like, yeah. Yeah, and then he told me Trump's coming out next week with this big speech, and boom. And I talked to Stone about it. The point is, it's all just intrigue. It's incredible. Let's play one more clip, and I'm going to go to our guest, who's just popping in today with some updates and some other medical news. Let's go ahead and play. Trump says we beat a rigged system. And you know what? We have so far when Sanders failed. Here it is.
Every election year, politicians promise change. Obama promised change, and it didn't work out too well. And every year, they fail to deliver. Why would politicians want to change a system that's totally rigged in order to keep them in power? That's what they're doing, folks. Why would politicians want to change a system that's right. Made them and their friends very, very wealthy? Yeah. I beat a rigged system. by winning with overwhelming support, the only way you could have done it, landslides all over the country, with every demographic on track to win 37 primary caucus victories in a field that began with 17 very talented people.
The man right there. Folks, the reason I personally told Ron Paul in his second run, and I told him in his first run for president, well, there was one before that in the 80s, but as a libertarian, but as a Republican, I said, listen, you got to get rid of Jesse Benton. I said, I don't want to get in your business, but I just, these decisions, and I'm not a political person when I'm watching it. And I said, you got to admit they're stealing these early states, because he was winning these early states. And he goes, well, Ron Paul, you know, he's talking about it on air. Well, they'll just say I got sour grapes. He's talked about this on air. Some of this has been public. I'm not only telling you secrets, it's just little stuff during the breaks talking to him. He wouldn't do it because he thought it was sour grapes. If it's true, it's true. And that's what I love about Trump. I've been telling him day one, when they were stealing early stuff from him, go crazy about it. And then you go, he's going to lose saying they're rigging it. That's just him, you know. No, expose the whole stinking thing or they'll steal it. With Donald Trump rallied against the rigged elections, he could make our elections free and open again, folks. People always say, I'm not going to vote because they'll just rig them. You get a landslide in there, you make them steal that. You bring down the whole enchilada. Now, I'm going to go to Dr. Group now. There's the quote. Oh, I'm really getting fired up right now. To all those Bernie Sanders supporters left out in the cold by a rigged system of superdelegates, we welcome with you with open arms, Donald Trump. That is a great comment. Now, let me tell you something. We're going to play that clip when Leanne's on, the other clips when Leanne's on. I don't want to cut into Group's time. We took time out to meet with us here today for like 30 minutes. We only have like 15 now. Dr. Group, you wanted to get into some medical news, but I also wanted to get you on because you developed Living Defense for us. It took you over a year to do it. It's got the kitchen sink in it. I didn't realize that with all the nutraceutical buffs, that, you know, with all the supplement buffs, that would be seen as the holy grail of the healthy, clean, detox, anti-parasite cleanse. It sold out in 2 days, and it took us, it sold out in December. One run, here we are, 6 months later, never had a product. I even tried to get you to take some of the stuff out of it so we would have it. We finally got some of it in, a pretty good shipment. And it's just amazing. So let's infomercial here, because this is important stuff. We got these big parasites. What about little parasites and other stuff? Why did this sell out? Because I never even really promoted it. It's got all these ingredients. Because we can see it's not even mainly our listeners coming in. It's outside folks buying this. Why is this so good?
Well, because people are actually waking up to the problem that pretty much scares me the most. I mean, I try to make sure that I don't put toxins from food and water and beverages in my system. But right now we're dealing with massive parasites, which is anything that's harmful to your body that lives off a host mechanism. Right now, with all the refugees spreading disease around, we have biological warfare going on everywhere. These are all parasites. We have Legionnaires outbreaks happening. Cases nearly quadrupled in the last 15 years.
TB from Texas to Minnesota. And they say, we don't even test them. We now put your kids with, they put the kids in the classes with our kids. Like an orgy of disease. Is this like some religion? Is this child sacrifice? What is this, Dr. Group?
I'm really thinking that it's all planned, because if you look at some of these conditions and then us opening up our borders and all the other countries opening up their borders, you're just dealing with a mass amount of parasites or harmful organisms or biological weapons that are spreading and mutating all across the world. And I think that's one of the reasons why. I mean, all you have to do is look at the news these days. You can type in refugees spreading disease. I mean, the CDC is going crazy right now. There's a new antibiotic resistant E. coli that they just identified. And in Britain, they're talking
about. They've got this sand fly that puts the parasite and it's killing hundreds of thousands, that eats the bacteria and it eats your body. And it's just, oh, come into Europe. Oh, kill us. Oh.
Yeah, that's called visceral leishmaniasis. And that's another thing that's spreading. It's a flesh eating disease. Some people.
Why are you discriminating against flesh-eating death?
Well, because I always try to find the answers to, you know, there's always a solution.
What's wrong with polio exploding, even though the vaccine isn't helping? What's wrong with that? Why are you racist against polio?
Well, I tell you what, they're actually coming out. I mean, I think part of the reason is, I think a lot of these things are biological that are man-made, and they're actually seeding the clouds, and they're seeding people with
sure,
these.
Sure, they're using the illegals as the cover that it's coming in. I agree.
Yeah, because...
Now suddenly Zika's weaponized, like you said months ago. Oh, suddenly it's mutated, more deadly. Oh, suddenly...
That's right. That's right. And as a matter of fact, President Obama just created a bill, I think, for $1.9 billion to fight Zika. And that's, I think, about to be in the Senate. We know that there was a hoax because it doesn't cause the birth defects and neurological diseases. But that is a scary situation because there's vaccines in development right now that are supposed to be coming out within the next 6 to 8 months. So you have the Zika, you have the tuberculosis that's happening right now, you have the flesh-eating disease, you have polio, you have measles.
And by the way, just to interrupt you, came out a few months ago that the Rockefeller Foundation isolated Zika in 54 and was involved in weaponizing it, and then magically it pops up. And what a perfect place to vector Zika worldwide, carried by humans through sexual transmission or blood transmission, they now admit it magically mutated, but through the Olympics coming up in Brazil. This is unprecedented.
Yeah, and the thing is, people can avoid toxic air if they want. They can get an air purification system. They can avoid toxic water and drink clean water. But it's really hard to avoid parasites. It's hard to avoid attacking organisms. And that's where I see this going. I mean, I think a lot of the information that we put out there and a lot of the products that we develop are specifically for that reason, to protect you against the endocrine disrupting chemicals, to protect you against all those chemicals and toxins. But here we are with billions of people being affected with different types of harmful organisms.
And I want to be clear, there's a reason the globalists never let all these third world diseases in, a lot of which they souped up and declassified that they aimed at the poor people. It's folks from Brazil or even the Middle East, these are victims, okay? And I really feel sorry for the folks from Latin America because they're not trying to put beekeeper suits on women and cut their genitals off. You know, that's my issue with the Muslims is, come on, man, my daughters will not be your slave. They're going to drive cars, they're going to do what they want. Shut up. Call me a racist or anti-feminine if you want. You will not put her in a freaking bee suit. Now, I'm sorry, but anyways, they're hitting, they've been caught, the UN's been caught, you know, Peru injecting people with syphilis. It wasn't just the black people, or injecting them with other garbage or polio. It's all come out. You can go to the registration of the Zika virus. It says Rockefeller Foundation, and the year that they did it, you cannot make any of this garbage up. And it makes me want to throw up that these people are now pouring in, and now the elites we know have gotten cures and treatments for themselves in case they get it, and that's why they're about to let the full West enjoy the population reduction and things that they've been under as well. You cannot make it up. And I said the 50s. It was 47. I was going from memory. Go ahead, Dr. Grubb.
No, I should apply for that $1.5 billion reward that British is thinking about offering somebody that comes up with a cure for this new E. coli and the fact that none of the antibiotics are working anymore. I mean, really, if you just take a combination of silver, oregano, the X2 iodine, and the living defense, you pretty much are protecting yourself and boosting your immune system against any type of
I had three bug. Family members die in 1 month of this lung-eating garbage. The hospitals were all full. It was barely in the news that a mystery illness was killing everybody. The doctors said they'd never seen this much death. Again, there was a cover-up of it. And my dad had it for over a month. Two different antibiotics didn't help him. He was in bed. And I literally forced him to drink close to 2 or 3 bottles of it in 1 week. And he said, that's bad for your kidneys, that level, which it is, folks. You don't want to take it much smaller dosages, okay? You know, something like 30 parts per million silver bullet. But I dumped, I think it was 3 bottles down him, knocked it out. Nothing else was working. So we're not saying it's a silver bullet, but it's darn close to it.
Yeah, it's just, I mean, the thing is, they don't want to go back to natural medicine. The natural products that we've developed are specifically designed and have even been tested by the U.S. military to be very strong at protecting the body.
When my uncle was dying 2 years ago, all over the hospital, they had silver sprays and silver creams, and they were just going, yeah, silver, oh! I mean, they know now, they know.
I tell you what, you know, just like Daniela Grace was on your show talking about all the prison systems, you got to remember the prisoners are being tested on, the soldiers are being tested on all over the world, not just U.S. military, but all military.
Oh, I remember a couple years before my uncle died there right down the road at Huntsville State Prison, maximum security. A bunch of people died of a mystery ailment. It turned out there was secret testing at that place that was even in the Houston Chronicle. I wonder, man, imagine what we don't know, Dr. Grubb.
I mean, I'm telling you, there's thousands and millions of organisms cruising around in our system that are taking our nutrients, reducing our immune system. And the thing is, doctors don't know. They don't teach doctors in medical school about parasites and harmful organisms. There's a reason why they don't teach them about that, just like they don't teach doctors about the root cause of disease and how to eliminate all disease out there. They don't want you to know about it. The parasites and harmful organism testing and the biological, I mean, most of these things can be tracked back to U.S. military or bioweapon laboratories that were specifically designed even before the Cold War to use for biological...
Lyme's disease, they admit, from a Nazi scientist off the coast of New York, 1952.
Right. The thing is, if you're suffering from abdominal pain, allergies, I mean, usually most of them, even like headaches, anemia, weakened immune system, gut problems, depression, hair loss, excess gas, muscle pain, nervousness. I mean, all these things, weight gain, mental, brain fog.
Let's talk about what's in Living Defense, because nothing's a panacea, but the stuff Mother Nature gave us is more and more folks admit, and this is what the elites are all into. Why is Living Defense so good? Tell us about all the stuff that said that there's so many things that are in it.
Right. So if you look across the board, what we wanted to do is try to attack as many different things and create
wildcrafted black walnut, green hull, organic.
Yep. You have the neem in there, you have the organic clove bud, the organic wormwood, you have enzyme blend in there. And this is very important because a lot of these microorganisms, and even going up to tapeworms, pinworms, you have to disintegrate the lining. I mean, on viruses are protect themselves, and so do bacteria and protozoa and mycoplasms. They have a protective shell that a lot of times the immune system can't even get into, our own immune system. Especially since most people's immune system are weak anyway.
And they secrete things to make us weaker so we're a better host.
Yeah, exactly. So we, and our
just
body
like Hillary.
Become acidic. So we actually designed the Living Defense and put in a specific blend of enzymes, which actually chew and eat through the lining of these different organisms. So the Living Defense is amazing. We've seen just tremendous reviews. As a matter of fact, a lady... that was so sick for 10 or 15 years had called the other day, been to 15 or 16 different doctors, was on her deathbed. She started doing the Living Defense. She said it was a miracle product. Very wealthy lady, saw the best doctors, went to the best hospitals in the world. No one could determine what was wrong with her. This is going on with practically every single person that goes to a doctor with symptoms. I can pretty much guarantee they have some level of parasites inside their body.
Even the New York Times a few months ago said most cancer now linked to the gut because the autoimmune system finally gives up, and that's why people aren't able to absorb any of the vitamins and minerals. And as you said, it's all the bad bacteria, the parasites, the yeast, the fungus. It's all in there, and you're dying because your gut is dying. And even the New York Times had all these big studies with the U.S. government admitting it. So at one side, they're killing us, but then there are good people compartmentalized getting reports out agreeing with you.
Yeah, I want to bring it to the public attention because anything we can do to help people, anything we can do to educate people and to be aware, it's just at this point in time, it's going crazy. It's everywhere in the news with the super bugs that are out there. It's just a lot more than ever. I mean, you can actually trace back, and there's been studies done on fossilized feces from the Vikings that showed that the Vikings suffered from parasites. And even ancient Rome was infested with human parasites. They're doing analysis now on fossilized feces.
Public schools and private schools are constantly sending letters home. I talked to all these parents with all these weird gut parasites spread, and all these third world parasites spreading now. And it's just totally insane. And how often should you take Living Defense? I mean, is it a regimen every day? That's what I was doing until we ran out. Or do you do it heavier for certain cleanses? What do you do, Dr. Group?
Well, I do usually 6 weeks at a time, because if you look at the life cycle of most parasites, but it's 6 weeks from the time.
So you got to kill the ones that are in there and then kill their babies when the eggs hatch up.
Exactly. So it takes 6 weeks from the time they lay their eggs until they're an adult.
So like even if we politically defeat Hillary, they've laid so many eggs, there'll be other generations of horrible criminals.
We have parasites. You're right. I mean, we have parasites all over that attack us. But the thing is, You don't want your own immune system being attacked. And with all of the, again, you know, you have animals, especially your cats, dogs. So many people have pets these days. People eat raw sushi. People eat more raw food. You have all these different organisms showing up in the water supplies now. You even have it in the air supplies, these tiny microorganisms. So it's not like we can get sure. away from them. We just have to do everything. I recommend doing a parasite cleanse at least twice a year.
All right. Well, I'm glad we've got some back in because I'm going back on it today. It just came back in yesterday. Living Defense, InfoWarsLife.com. And folks, you can't lose. It's full of stuff that's great for your body, period. And you support the broadcast, InfoWarsLife.com. Thank you, Dr. Group from the Global Healing Center. Thank you so much for all your work, sir, on this great product.
Thanks for having me on, Alex.
We'll be back with more on the election and more on Bilderberg. All right, let's get serious. Bill O'Reilly defends Hillary. Don't call her crooked. Crooked, now come on, he said. Crooked? I mean, she's been more in scandals and more evil than anybody I could ever imagine. I mean, she's like, you know, herpes just keeps coming back over and over again. And then another article, Trump banned BuzzFeed reporter from speech. Credentialed InfoWars. InfoWars is the nation's leading conspiracy theory website, which means we know what we're talking about. But, you know, I mean, I trust Larry Nichols, and I love him, but he was telling me last week, actually, on air, he was saying it, but then over the weekend and then Monday, I'm communicating directly to the Trump people, but I told them I don't want to meet with them because they'll make a big issue out of it, as you know, Alex. And there he's got a big speech coming up the week after next, and I need to give vet their intel for him. And I'm just like, yesterday, I'm like, well, Larry, we're too full today, but let me get you on the next few days. All right, but they need it now, Alex. And then Trump comes out that night and goes, my big speech next week. And I'm like, okay, well, I know Trump listens to the show, so we'll try to line that up and communicate this way. I'm not trying to sound big. It's true. It freaks me out. The New York Times comes out in two articles and goes, InfoWars is the brain of Trump. Well, that's not really true. They just know we research, we vet things. We didn't come out first with the La Raza connection to this judge. Daily Caller did. We went and looked up more, put it out. WorldNet Daily looked out more. Drudge linked to it. The truth is, we'll just go where the truth is. I mean, it's not rocket science. And we're into the world. Like, we remember Laura Allen Hughes and the communist generals and their names and the Chinese generals and what happened at the White House. And it was on C-SPAN. And we want to make that news again, because it's news. Like if somebody was a Russian spy when they were 20, and now they're going to be 70, or a Chinese spy, we'd be concerned. No, this was just 20 years ago, or 18 years ago. Of course it's pertinent. But it is true that our info gets to Trump. And I'll just leave it at that. And Anthony Gucciardi's a smart cookie. I don't know if it was a rhetorical question that I'm going to Leanne McAdoo. But he asked me, during the break, because Don Salazar ran and said, look, Media Matters is like writing about you 10 times a day. He's like, there's like, you know, 8 or 9 articles here. It's like everything you say, what is going on? And then Anthony goes, they'd be bankrupt if it wasn't for us. All they cover is you and Trump and Drudge. And I went, Anthony, you know why? And he goes, well, because we're newsworthy or whatever. And I said, yeah, but this is run by the White House and the Clintons on record. The former transition chief for Obama runs it. It's all full of Clinton people. Clinton gives them directives. So this is who they're scared of. They're scared of Drudge. They're scared of Trump. They're scared of InfoWars. They used to cover Fox. That's in their hip pocket now. They cover us. This is the enemies list. I am so proud of this. This is like a Congressional Medal of Honor, having these traitors that are funded by a Nazi collaborator, a war criminal, their main funder. I mean, I am ecstatic. People say, is it rough being attacked? Attacked? It'd be like if a NAMBLA came out against me. By the way, they've had Salon and pedophiles on there come out against me. Good! I better have pedophiles coming out against me. You know a man by his enemies. I love it. I like it. Love it. Like it. Love it. I'm 18. I'm 42 and feel like I'm 18. I'll tell you that right now. Feel better than I felt when I was 18 because now I know what it's all about. And I'm into the zeitgeist. I'm going in like a kamikaze into the New World Order, and I love it. I absolutely love not having fear because my only fear is that they're going to win. You see, that's a big secret right there, being totally committed to, and being committed to the zeitgeist. All the doors start opening up. But then you got to be ready when you actually walk out on that final sand gladiatorial event, because in this type of destiny, you usually don't make it all the way to the end, but your spirit takes everybody else over the top. And you got to be ready. You got to be committed. You got to, God's got to know that you have got that eye of the tiger. And then all the doors open. But just know, you got to have the will to want to take on evil for the innocence. It's not about who you are. Sure, I come off as super aggressive and arrogant and wild. No, it's just confidence out of a suicide mission. And I see that same confidence in Donald Trump and whoever he was before. Entering this crucible is only making him stronger. All right, we're going to go to Leanne McAdoo in 30 seconds. I think she's in Long Beach. I know it's a beautiful shot of her out there at the beach, but this is amazing. We're going to be getting to all of this. But I tell you, Leanne, you're getting demonized out there. You're being attacked. That is just a mark of your courage as well, all the stuff you've gone through. I thought Joe Biggs was still there. I don't know. You know, he's here, I'm told, so if he's not at lunch, let's try to get him in here as well. He was out there earlier than you. You've seen so much craziness, Leanne. You couldn't hardly find anybody that was voting for Hillary, but she still won. But the New York Daily News admits because she was appointed by the superdelegates. What is your takeaway from all of your last 4 or 5 days out there, Leanne?
Thanks, Alex. Yes, we're actually here in Huntington Beach, California, experiencing the eerie aftermath of the possibility of a Hillary Clinton presidency.
As a woman, are you feeling empowered right now?
I am feeling like we can do a whole lot better than that. And I'm feeling very duped that I have to be proud. Oh, she broke the glass ceiling. Actually, math broke the glass ceiling for her. It wasn't the will of the American people with her secret superdelegates that were tipping it in her favor before the race even had begun. So I feel very duped, and I don't want to get excited about that as a woman. So I don't know.
Look, I would love to have a great black president that was a wonderful patriot. And that would just be prideful for everybody. Instead, right. It's like the so-called black president doubles black unemployment. It's horrible. I mean, if I was a black person, I would not want him to represent me.
Right. What has he done for the black community?
What's he done for anybody but globalist? He goes to Africa to fund more forced abortions, basically. And then he tells them they can't have air conditioning or cars.
Right. They can't evolve. They can't improve their quality of life because then the world would tip over or whatever excuse he gave them. It was really interesting listening to you talking to Dr. Group about the life cycle of parasites. As disgusting as that is to think, it's actually so appropriate for what we've sort of learned here in California. Last night, I'm not sure if you saw the video we put out about the Democratic Socialist plot to take over America revealed. These were women who they've been longtime political activists. They kind of started the whole gay marriage thing here in California, and the lady was just like seething.
Yeah, set that up in a moment, and we'll play that clip. In fact, I meant to say that's one reason you're on. Amazing footage you got out in California with Zimmerman.
Yeah, and I mean, just these people, we went to several different polling locations, and we did go to West Hollywood. It's mostly just a gay community there, and that was where all of the Hillary supporters were, which is like, how have you even been duped? What has she done for the gay community? Her husband was one of the people who reinforced the DOMA, so a Defense of Marriage Act, you know, and then all of a sudden she evolved on the issue.
Yeah, tell us who these creatures are that you interviewed.
Well, there's one video you can see, Hillary Clinton's biggest fan, and he is supposed to be out there every day. He's getting people to come vote for Hillary, and he has absolutely no idea. He's like, oh, the FBI, they closed their case 6 months ago, and that's just fine. And TPP, oh, she didn't do that. And, you know, and he's out here like drunkenly, like slovenly, oh, vote for Hillary. Oh, this is the future of the country.
Yeah, that's it. You cannot overestimate or over-exaggerate how slovenly, dumb even their leadership is. But their minions can hardly talk of every race, color, and creed. What have they done to these people? I'm serious. I mean, I feel like we should make a pamphlet we hand out that says, are you a zombie?
Yeah.
And it's like written for a 5-year-old.
Well, getting back to the whole parasite, the cycle of parasites. So this woman, you know, she's talking about how, like, you know, we're going to take over. I'm a proud Democratic socialist. And Hillary, she's our gal. You know, she's going to push this through. And whatever happens, we can see with all these young Bernie supporters who are just out here spouting off those talking points. They are primed and ready to keep the life cycle, this parasitic lifestyle cycle going because they have been primed and programmed now for many years, if not decades, pushing through this Democratic Socialist agenda. And they're so excited because they can finally see it about to happen with Hillary.
Now they finally got enough of the public that literally, they say laces and shoes is going out because people don't like the time or don't know how.
Just need some slip-ons.
Here, let's go ahead and play Democratic Socialist Plot for America Reveal that Leanne McAdoo shot yesterday. And we'll go back to McAdoo and ask about where is this mystery Hillary's voter? She finally found some. But they openly meant they stole it from, I'm going to give you everything for free. But let's go ahead. But she doesn't give them too much of the trillionaire's money. They just want to give chicken feed out. So I guess Sanders is better for the average socialist out there. But let's go to this clip.
Leah McAdoo with Infowars.com. I am here in West Hollywood, California, and the polls are about 15 seconds from closing. We're still waiting to see, could Bernie Sanders potentially take California, even though they've already called it for Hillary Clinton? The math has made history. The superdelegates have decided tonight. You can see they're counting down.
Yay, superdelegate!
This is the key race here in California, 400 plus delegates to be won here in California. Of course, it's still too early to call, but they've already called it late last night. We're going to go find out from these women. We would just like to know, what does the country have to look forward to with a Hillary Clinton presidency? Hillary Clinton for president, what does the country look like?
If she becomes president, well, first of all, the country looks a lot more united instead of divided. The country looks a lot less racist. The country wakes up the morning she gets in with hope and not fear. She doesn't practice the politics of fear. And I think it's great. What is better than a wonderful, strong, experienced woman?
And so what do you want to say to all the young Bernie supporters out there who have said that they're going to go vote for Trump rather than Hillary Clinton, and they don't like her scandals, they don't like the kind of trail that's sort of following her? How do you talk to those people and make them overlook that?
My name is Robin Tyler. I'm a Democratic Socialist. I produced 3 marches on Washington, major marches with 1 million people. And being a Democratic Socialist and having been an activist since the 60s, I understand their excitement, and I understand their disappointment in not having the candidate get in. But this is not about Bernie Sanders. This is about a movement. I have been in the anti-war movement, the feminist movement, the anti-racism movement. And so what's great about them is, rather than imploding our movement and our Democratic Party, what's great is they can use this instead of imploding, exploding to be this fantastic.
Yeah, stealing elections is good. Of course it is for communists.
This movement, and I'm a Democratic Socialist.
You're a commie.
This movement will run the country.
Look at the cult
and I
lady
think that's great.
Next to her, your TV viewer. These are
Hillary,
scary people.
The right wing has been getting her for 25 years. She's not in jail. She's never
the one smiling. Yeah, we're winning. We're somebody now. The mega banks and Chinese generals with slave factories. Apple suicide nets.
Even from the left.
But yeah, she admits the whole plan. Sorry.
I'm a major activist, and I'm for Hillary Clinton.
Okay, can we pull up the death of the emperor from the Dark Crystal? Because I want to show this lady's acting role without makeup on. Leanne, I'm sorry. The Drudge Report, media goddess. Hillary is a media goddess, and Richard Simmons is transitioning into a woman. I thought he always was.
Right.
I'm sorry. It's, who cares? I always thought he was funny. But okay, let's work out now. Yeah. CNN depicts history-making Hillary Clinton as glowing golden god. They actually said that. All planned to blur it out and blast her with spotlights. The Christ goddess. If this is a goddess, I don't want anywhere near him. Marilyn Monroe, a goddess. Leanne McAdoo, but not Herr Hillary. I'm sorry. Go ahead there, goddess.
Well, that's what I agree with. I mean, if you could see the look on that lady's face, and she just was so sure to point out how she's a Democratic Socialist, but Hillary is the one. And that is the whole point, is Bernie Sanders was never even going to be president. It was all for the money and to push the left even further into more progressive issues, more progressive.
That's it. They admit he was there to move it all to the left and normalize it so she could look more conservative.
And now the buzzword is like, they're going to unite the country. We won't be racist anymore. We'll be.
And we've got re-education centers for the people that don't want to, actually in the Army official files now.
Exactly. And that was what was so frightening, just the look in her eyes. And I had a report early in January when Hillary Clinton, Debbie Wasserman Schultz couldn't tell the difference. They couldn't express, well, what is the difference between a Democrat and a socialist? And they were just like, well, I'm not a socialist. And they're like, but what's the difference? So I did a video on that and pointed out how if you go to the Socialists of America, the Young Socialists of America, their website, they talk about how, you know, what is a Democrat, a socialist? And that they linked up with the Democratic Party because they felt they were the ones who were going to be the most powerful to
That's
push
right.
the agenda in America.
And then if you watch these women, you know, when the mastermind's talking, the other one's like in rapture when she talks about the sneak attack plan. I mean, these are whacked out loons who want us to live like Russia and Venezuela or Cuba. These are whack jobs.
Yeah, and they are like so seething with power that in the next 4 years, this is going to be running the country. And all these are going to fall in line. And we talked to some people out here on the beach, and they're like, yeah, socialism, it's great. It's for the collective and not the individual. They don't even know what that means.
Why are you against the golden goddess?
Yeah. Well, so the collective decides that we're going to gas the Jews, right? And then they're like, oh, well, that's not good.
The collective decides we're going to take all the middle class's money. That's okay.
Yeah. And that's what these people don't understand. They think that, oh, we're unified. Let's all just get
no,
unified.
The prosperity's all going out the window, and a bunch of soft nobodies that don't even work, who show up once a year to politically bang on pots and pans, are not going to be given full control. And they're so weak-minded, when we totally collapse, they'll never even admit it, because they'll have a power trip, even as their ceilings caved in like Cuba.
Right. I mean, we have got to stop this, Alex. That was what was so frightening to me last night, and just talking to these little socialists in the making. It's frightening, and we have got to turn this thing around.
I don't know what they're putting the water out in California. Those are the dumbest people. And you look who rules them, a bunch of smiling loons, you know, about how they deceived everyone and how they're taking over, and there's no election, really. What matters is our movement, a movement that'll come for you and your family as sure as the sun came up. Sleeping giant, awaken! The hordes are upon us! Rise and resist! The Vikings called it the joy of battle.
That's a terror in each sip and in each sup.
And when you are in a physical death battle, you either give up and succumb, or your body and all of your instincts and your senses goes into a hyper overdrive, and it's the highest you'll ever be in your life. I am fortunate enough, you could say unfortunate enough, to experience that a few times. So a lot of people that are in that situation a lot become addicted to it. But I'll tell you, I'll take that animating contest of the death battle over the zombiosis of just, everything's mine, I'm a victim, I deserve stuff, with these elites that are building space stations, going, oh yeah, we'll give you some free stuff, cupcakes, when they literally see you as dead animals. And they helped make you like this. They helped set it up so you'd be like this. I don't know who's worse, quite frankly. I guess the engineers. But Leanne, I tell you, you know, out there experiencing these people, I know she used to be what you call more liberal. So was I. It's not just that I was younger. I mean, I like liberal ideas, but it's that they twist it all. And it's all about being in control. And then, like, we don't have elections, really. It's our takeover, our agenda. And it was, like, really creepy, weird old cult-like women. And then, you know, and the Huffington Post came out and said, basically, kill Donald Trump, attack his supporters. They deserve it. They're not human. These are scary people, folks. But what's really scary is rolling over to them. These people aren't going to run the nuclear reactors and do the dirty jobs and work hard. Everything's just going to collapse with a bunch of, I don't know what to even say anymore. Leanne McAdoo, other points. We got a fresh horse in the fight coming in. Hard charger, David Knight. What an amazing broadcast so far today. But other points, Leanne from the coast of California.
Well, I mean, what do we do at this point, Alex? Because we can see where she is going with this. They're going to the media, who's already calling her the golden glowing goddess.
Oh, the goddess.
And everything Trump says, they're not going to do a little digging and understand the La Raza connections there. They don't even want to know who that is, because let's not forget, Hillary Clinton is considering one of the Castro brothers for her vice presidency. He and his twin brother, who was on Obama's side, their mom was one of the founding members of La Raza. So these are people, they don't want you looking over in that direction. They don't want you seeing
this judge's law firm is running a boycott campaign of Trump.
Yeah,
and the media is like, how ridiculous that he's anti-Trump. How ridiculous, preposterous. Ooh.
Oh, who could bias? And this is at a time in the country when everyone's like, how can a white police officer be fair to a black person? Or, you know, how
And Sotomayor told the New York Times, she said, I, as you know, this Latin woman can have a better decision than white men.
Exactly. It's only okay if it's coming from the other side. But that's what's going to happen is that everything Trump says from here on out, they're going to make him sound like this total monster.
It's very cynical against Hispanics and other groups. But Hispanics, I mean, are America, are the future. We're always here, the Native Americans. It's ridiculous how you're Hispanic, you're Mexican. No, you're a Native American mixed with European. You know, it's like, it's all this stupid debate. And it's like, don't you want a Bill of Rights, Constitution, prosperity? That's why people come here. They're being force-fed all this race garbage and lies and BS. And on the other side, it is generating a bunch of white racism that was pretty much almost extinct. Yeah. Now it's just all this paranoia and all this craziness. I just can't stand it anymore. And right. I tell you, it's just explosive. Stay there. I want to come back to a few more minutes with Leanne McAdoo. And we'll also give you her Twitter and more. I'm at Real Alex Jones on Twitter. Please magnify all of our material. This is a war. Get conscious. Get activated. Break the trance. Go to the next level. Fix bayonets and charge. Yes, awakened humanity is on the march. The empire is on the run. The problem is awakened humanity's 30-40%. The other 30-40% is totally mindless, and another 20-30% just doesn't care. But it was 5% or less that won the Revolutionary War, so I'm not that worried about it. But, man, and the good news is I'm not being stereotypical. This is just what I've experienced. The dumbest people are white people. Either some of the smartest awake folks are white people, or also, it's a paradox, the dumbest are white trendies and yuppies and the hippie generation, which had a lot of great ideas. And, you know, I know a lot of old hippies that are the coolest, most awake people out there, but kind of the trendy modern hippie. And then you've got super dumb Hispanics, super dumb black people I run into. But I'll tell you, as a general group, I've found Hispanics more awake to the New World Order and paranoid about stuff and informed than white people. And a lot of black folks are awake, but they still vote like, you know, 90% Democratic, though that's changing with Trump. And I'm not saying, look how bad Republicans are. I mean, I get why you wouldn't trust them. It's just that I don't understand how it's supposedly there's all this white racism, but then the people running the show are a bunch of just weird, squatting white people. And I'm kind of just digressing, but look at Bill O'Reilly, defends Hillary, says don't call her crooked on his show. The clip's up on Infowars.com. I mean, she's totally crooked. What are they afraid of? Are they afraid that they'll bring up that he had to settle a sexual harassment case? And by the way, some of the tapes got released in the transcripts before he settled, where he said the most perverted pressuring women to have sex that worked with him and calling him up like a creep. And over and over and over again. And then he had the nerve to go, sexual predators online are a problem, and cuts to a clip of me talking about corrupt police. Those are fighting words, you piece of crap. I mean, I'm sorry, Bill O'Reilly, but you're a creep. Of course women don't want you. So let's go to the clip of the pervert.
The surprise that crooked Hillary wins in the state.
Crooked,
the Sopranos.
See, no, crooked Hillary on his program. Trump can do that because that's what he does, not you.
Yeah, and again, you put me on a program about sexual predators, you piece of filth. You are a pervert. And I challenge Bill O'Reilly to get in a ring 12 rounds. And if you want to go, no gloves, you want to go bare knuckles, let's do it. I bet you're a tough Irish guy. Your dad's a tough Irish cop. You're a lot older than me. You think you're like 6'5", whatever? You're an old man? Tell you what, you and two midgets, you can get, just to balance it out. Two ninja-trained midgets, and we'll all three go in there. I'll be serious. You can pick one other person. All I want to get is a big swing on your big, fat, ugly melon. I'm just joking. I actually don't want to hurt you. You're hurting yourself. You sell out. He used to do shows about JFK, the New World Order, back when he was on Hard Copy or Extra or whatever it was. Must feel bad to be Bill O'Reilly all blackmailed with whatever he's been doing with this ding-ding. Excuse me, Leanne, I apologize. We got 2 minutes to break. David Knight's coming up. If you want to ride shotgun, you can. But just go ahead and finish your points. I'm sorry I'm ranting.
Well, Alex, we're out here in the land of the Justin Bieber worshippers. So I had to play one of your rants for Zimmerman, who had never heard your Justin Bieber rant about Magellan. And, it, you know, just so inspiring to just wake people up. And there you explain it perfectly, how they are trying to steal your humanity from you, steal your ingenuity from you, and tell you that Justin Bieber is the God and that's who you should worship. And taking this away from everyone. And, you know, I encourage everyone to go look at that rant, set it as your alarm clock, wake up every day powerful and ready to fight the globalists and the New World Order. I know that was super inspiring for us today. But, I mean, it's really kind of scary when you see that, yeah, we've got these nitwits out here who are voting and, you know, with their idiocracy, they're voting. But then we're seeing that it doesn't even matter. Their idiotic votes don't even count. And they're just going to, and they're actually happy about the fact that the superdelegates, because it's their gal who won. So it's fine this time around if the system's all corrupt. We'll fix it next time around.
How long is that Justin Bieber rant, the shorter version? Maybe David Knight wants to air that in the next segment.
I think it's about 3 minutes.
Can we pull up the Justin Bieber? You know what? I got a bunch of meetings to go to, and the woods are lovely dark and deep. There's miles to go before I sleep, but I'm going to hold over. We're going to pull up the Justin Bieber and play it and then hand the baton to David Knight. Great job, Leanne McAdoo. And who knows, Knight may want you to pop back in, but you're filing a bunch of reports. Incredible job, Leanne McAdoo.
Thanks, Alex. We'll see you when we get back.
You bet. Is the football, the basketball, the Lady Gaga, the Justin Bieber, you know, who gives you these carbon tax messages. They tell your kids they got to love Justin Bieber, and then Bieber says, hand in your guns, pass the Cybersecurity Act, and, you know, the police state's good, and then your children are turned into mindless vassals who now they look up to some twit instead of looking up to Thomas Jefferson or looking up to Nikola Tesla or looking up to Magellan. I mean, kids, Magellan's a lot cooler than Justin Bieber. He circumnavigated with one ship the entire planet. He was killed by wild natives before they got back to Portugal, and when they got back, there was only like 11 people alive of the 200 and something crew, and the entire ship was rotting down to the waterline. That's destiny. That's will. That's striving. That's being a trailblazer, an explorer, going into space, mathematics, quantum mechanics, the secrets of the universe. It's all there. Life is fiery with its beauty, its incredible detail. Tuning into it. They want to shatter your mind talking about Justin Bieber. It's pure evil. They're taking your intellect, your soul, and giving you Michael Jordan and Bieber. Unlock your human potential. Defeat the globalists who want to shatter your mind, your doorways to perception. I want to see you truly live. I want to see you truly be who you are. Ah, I don't want my progeny who's coming, my unborn grandchildren and great-grandchildren, to live in this nightmare system these control freaks have created, where these wicked globalists are so threatened by human potential, they poison the water, the vaccines, the food, to turn us into a bunch of slugs, a bunch of lobotomized sloths so they can control us. It is a crime. It is the most jealous, envious, greedy, hateful, sickening thing the New World Order does. And that's why I am so pleased to be committed in the fight against them. That's why I don't care about my own life, except I want to continue to live to fight them. That's why I don't have fear. I only have fear of myself and my flesh and not being up to the challenge. And I ask you to look in the mirror and ask yourselves, what are you doing in this time of great challenge? What are you doing to unlock minds? Once you unlock a mind, once you unlock somebody, then they can unlock their soul. We can't unlock a soul. Only God can do that. But we can unlock minds. And once the mind is unlocked, once the intellect is turned on, then comes the discernment. Then comes the awakening of the soul. Then comes true enlightenment and empowerment. So the globalists seek to make you a bunch of jealous, stunted, weak, backstabbing, gibbering demons. All of us have the lower elements and the higher. We must strive for the higher. Stay with us!
All right, that's Alex Jones' great rant about Justin Bieber and the people in society that are being dumbed down by this culture. I'm David Knight. This is the fourth hour of the Alex Jones broadcast. And I'm still picturing, as I'm watching Alex in his passion, I'm still picturing him in the ring with Bill O'Reilly and two ninja midgets. I would pay to see that, and I would lay a side bet on Alex. They could throw Justin Bieber in there, too, as well. I'd still bet on Alex with all four of them. You know, this is where we are, though, folks. When we look at the arrogance of Bill O'Reilly saying, don't call Hillary Clinton crooked. Really? Come on. The transparency of the suck-up, I'm with her media that pretends that they are conservative Republicans. I mean, it's not just the people like Paul Ryan. We've seen this. They work hand in glove with each other, many of these people in Fox News. Here's Hugh Hewitt. Okay, and you saw him in one of the debates. He's got a radio show. The Hill says the GOP should change their convention rules to drop Trump. And I'm looking at this and I'm thinking, what arrogance. What arrogance. And we just looked at the massive increase in votes, a record number of votes that Trump has gotten this time. I think 1.5 million votes higher than the previous record. You look at the fact that the votes up 40% over the previous record. You see that Hillary is crashing 30% less in California than she did the last time she ran in 2008. And he has the audacity, as The Hill calls him, this influential conservative radio host. Yeah, he's influential because he gets supported by the establishment that supports these establishment Republicans, these establishment neocon media. And you know, the Never Trump establishment is really going through their bench pretty quickly. National Review's been thoroughly discredited. You've had Glenn Beck thoroughly discredited. You got Bill Kristol, who is a laughing stock now. It's just a week ago. Wasn't it just a week ago that he came out and said, we're going to have a real credible independent candidate to run? And then a couple of days later, it was some unknown writer from his own publication, the Weekly Standard. And remember, you spell that weekly with an A. Okay, because that's what they put out. And he also wrote for the thoroughly discredited now National Review, David French. And then he thought about it for a week, and he says, I prayed about it, and I guess he realized he didn't have a prayer. He's out. It wasn't even reasonable for him to get in. At this point, there's a thing called ballot access. These people don't even seem to understand what that is. But, of course, they're used to the rules being waived for them, just like they waived the rules for John Kasich. We saw this many times when working to get on the ballot with the Libertarian Party, that you would have a Republican who didn't file, and it would be a predominantly Democrat district. They'd say, well, we're not even going to bother to put anybody up against this person. And then the Libertarians got on the ballot and ran somebody. And after the deadline was passed, the Republicans say, oh, wait a minute, we don't want to not be on the ballot. So they would go into the judge and they'd say, well, you know, we missed the deadline and you got all these rules and everything, but can't you just change the rules for us? They would do it every time. They'll never do it for an independent. They'll never do it for a third party. Only for the two establishment parties. And that's what we're seeing in the way that they rigged this election for Bernie Sanders. And Trump called him on it. That's a great thing. And he's going to call him on it if they rig the election. But it hasn't stopped people like Hugh Hewitt calling for them to rig the election. He says, I think the party ought to change the nominee. He thinks still, at this point, got to get rid of Trump at the convention. He's still calling for this kind of underhanded treatment. He said, because we're going to get killed with this nominee. They ought to get together and let the convention decide. How many times are they going to go down this narrative? They never give it up. And look, we need to talk about these delegates. And we need to see what's, they need to understand that they're not going to get away with this. People need to make it clear to them. They still think they can get away with this, these neocons. Who are these delegates? Where do they come from? Who are they loyal to? Think about the Electoral College delegates, for example. Who are these guys? Well, whenever you run, and again, you have to win the state. Remember, Ross Perot got 20% of the popular vote, but he didn't get a single Electoral College delegate because they're awarded on a winner-take-all basis, state by state. And that's a good. There's a good reason for that, too, folks. We can talk about that some other time. But let's talk about just who these delegates are. When you run as a Republican, as a Democrat, as a third-party candidate, you would submit a list of who your Electoral College delegates are going to be. So like in North Carolina, we had, I think it was 12 congressional districts. So you would get one delegate for each of those congressional districts. I was on the list in case the Libertarian won in North Carolina. And if that had happened, they would have sent 12 people that the party had nominated that were going to be loyal to them, and they would go to the convention. And it's interesting. I think it was back in 1976. They had the Libertarians had a guy who was a Republican elector. I think he was from California. He was a guy who was a producer of Little House on the Prairie, Roger McBride. He's descended from Laura Ingalls Wilder's and Rose Wilder Lane, who wrote the book. And he went to the Electoral College as a Republican elector. He was supposed to cast a vote. And I guess, who was it in 76? Ford, I think. Anyway, he didn't vote for the Republican. Instead, he cast a vote for the Libertarian Party. And they registered that because these people can do that. Now, you're going to be completely exiled from any political activity of that party, of course, forever. That ends all your connection then. But that's the only penalty. I mean, there's not any law that prevents that. So people can do that even at the Electoral College. And then when you get to the actual GOP convention, as we've seen, they will have these elections and they say, well, Trump got X number of delegates and Cruz got X number of delegates. And then you find out that Cruz goes in and he gets to pick the delegates who are going to go, who are loyal to him, instead of delegates who are loyal to Trump. I mean, it's not done like the Electoral College. It isn't done where you go into each individual state and Trump says, okay, you know, there's 50 delegates that are going to go to the convention. Here's my list of 50 people that I know are going to be loyal to me. And then Cruz comes in with his list and they say, okay, well, you got 30 delegates, Trump. So, you know, which 30 of the 50 that do you want to go? No, they don't do it that way. They hold a separate, secret election. That's the way the Republicans try to rig the election. And so you've got all these guys now who they say they're going to be bound to Trump on the first thing. But, you know, you still got Hugh Hewitt, who maybe he doesn't understand what the process is, but he's still calling on these people to not listen to the voters. Don't listen to the voters. We got a record number of voters who have voted for Donald Trump. He's brought in people who are independents, people who have never voted before, people who are from the other party, the Democrats. But ignore that, because we, the establishment that Hugh Hewitt works for, don't like him. We don't like him. So we're going to throw that out, just as George Will had said in the past. So amazing arrogance. Continuing to this point where, what, Trump's got 1,500 or something out of the only 1,200 and so that he needed, hundreds more than he needs, millions of votes more than they've ever had, and yet it's not good enough for the neocon mouthpieces. And this is what we are up against. And we're also up against Hillary Clinton, and this is going to be interesting. We got a story that's up on Infowars.com we'll talk about when we come back. Hillary in 2006 says the U.S. needs a physical barrier to keep U.S. Mexicans out. So we're going to go into that. And then the next segment, we're going to talk about Bilderberg and something called the precariat. Haven't heard that word before, have you? But it's all the rage in Bilderberg. They're worried about this dangerous class of people they've created with their globalism. Stay with us. We'll be right back and tell you what that is. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host in this live fourth hour. We're going to go back to Hillary Clinton, and we have a new exclusive article at Infowars.com from Roger Stone about her university scandal, and it is huge compared to Donald Trump's. Before I get back to that, I want to let you know that we have Living Defense back in stock at InfowarsLife.com. It has been out of stock for a very long time. We have, as we pointed out on the website, 9 out of 10 people are infested with harmful organisms. Once these organisms have made it in your body, they steal nutrients, they release toxic waste. This is a way to cleanse your body. Living Defense is now back in stock at InfowarsLife.com. It uses organic herbs and enzymes to help naturally cleanse harmful organisms from the body. Read the reviews at InfowarsLife.com. See why it sold out so quickly. And again, you can find that back in stock after a very long absence at InfowarsLife.com. Now, real quickly, as a preface before I talk about this story here, the hypocrisy of Crooked Hillary. And it's nowhere better than in this article here that we've got up at Infowars.com. Hillary in 2006, the U.S. needs physical barrier to keep Mexicans out. But of course, as they point out, it's only racist when Donald Trump says that. And we have it on video. She's speaking to the Council on Foreign Relations in 2006 because they had a different way of handling it back then, right? Now they've got, they've embraced open borders, bringing in people to bring down our economy. So now it's all changed. You know, she's gotten the new memo from the CFR, and they're doing it a little bit differently now. But, you know, this was the conventional wisdom of the globalists back then. And Hillary is saying, well, the policies of Mexico are, quote, this is what she says, pushing migration north across our border, unquote. She says we need to, and listen to this, secure our borders. Hillary Clinton actually said, secure our borders. You won't hear her say that in 2016, 10 years later. And she says, and we need to secure our borders with physical barriers. And we need tougher employer sanctions for those who hire illegals. We need to deport those who have committed transgressions. Deport is her word. Committed transgressions, that's something she said. Physical barriers, she said that. But that was 10 years ago. And now if we see the need for that, if we got a candidate like Donald Trump who sees the need for that, he's racist, and so are we. And, of course, we are going to see a lot of these types of things coming out from the Secret Service people that have worked for her. As we had a caller last night who called in and said she and her other military friends who went to see 13 Hours, a story about Benghazi, were so disturbed by it that they just were speechless as they left the movie, and they huddled together and just prayed outside the movie theater. They're so disturbed by the criminality and the cold sociopathic attitude of Hillary Clinton and the other people who made those decisions to stand down. And of course, we've got the Secret Service revelations that are coming out, and we've got an article up on Infowars.com right now, a quote from Ron Kessler, who is an investigative reporter for the Washington Post. Secret Service agent says, "Good morning" to Hillary. She responds to two words. Guess what those two words are? F off. Can you imagine that? The people who are tasked with laying their lives down to protect you. And you walk out and one of them says, "Good morning, ma'am." And you say to that person who has pledged to protect your life with his, she responds by saying, F off. That's the Hillary Clinton that the people around her know. That's the Hillary Clinton you're going to know by the time this campaign is out. Because no matter how much the Hugh Hewitts and the Bill O'Reillys want to cover it up, it's going to come out. The truth is going to come out. People who know her are going to talk about this. Now, the exclusive article that we've got on Infowars.com from Roger Stone, and this is very important. It's a very long article. You need to see this article because he lays out the detail. And as Donald Trump said in his speech last night, the Clintons have turned the politics of personal enrichment into an art form for themselves, and they've stolen millions of dollars. He says, I mean hundreds of millions of dollars. Here's one of the ways that they did it. Exclusive. Media ignores Clinton University scandal worse than Trump University. Trump University problems are a skin blemish compared to the Clintons' laureate leprosy. And this is a story from Roger Stone. He said, the Clinton Global Initiative joint venture with an organization called Laureate Education, a shaky for-profit chain of schools to create Clinton Global Initiative University, is the final step in an incredible predatory stock deal, because they always do it in a very complicated way. Laureate Education deal used high-pressure boiler room tactics to rack up $750 million of debt on students while running a $457 million debt at the same time Bill Clinton was taking lavish but hidden compensation from Laureate, while Hillary's State Department was lavishing $150 million from the chain of for-profit schools that has a 50% graduation rate, a very high dropout rate. That's an exclusive story up on Infowars.com. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight on this Wednesday, June 8th, 2016. I was just talking about the exclusive story we have at Infowars.com by Roger Stone. Media ignores Clinton University scandal that is worse than Trump University. This is a school where they had the students run up $750 million worth of debt. $750 million worth of debt, high-pressure tactics to get them to enroll in this. Bill Clinton took a lavish salary, and they had a 50% graduation rate. Now, I'm telling you, this isn't because they can't handle the calculus and the math courses here, okay? It's because they can't handle the Clinton calculations of putting them under astronomical debt, okay? I'm sure this is not an academically rigorous standard here. That's not the reason for the high attrition rate. This is a very detailed article. You need to take a look at this, again, exclusively at Infowars.com, an article by Roger Stone, really laying out this Clinton University scandal in detail that we haven't seen before. So this is an article that really needs to go viral. So pass that around. Read that. Pass that around. We need to get people to understand what a crook these people are. Because we're going to have people like Bill O'Reilly on Fox News saying, don't talk to us about Hillary Clinton being a crook. She can't be a crook. She can't be racist, even though she called for the same policies 10 years ago. Yeah, we need to get a physical barrier. Mexico is driving people into this country. We need sanctions against employers. We need to deport them. All these things that they're saying, that's racist, racist, racist. She was saying them all 10 years ago. And we have the video. You can run, Hillary, but you can't hide. We got a lot of video. It's all over the place. It's starting to surface from some of the more obscure places, like the Council on Foreign Relations, those buddies of yours. So that's going to come out. Now, I want to talk about Bilderberg. When we look at the Bilderberg meeting and what their agenda is, according to Bilderberg, they say it's going to be things like current events. It's kind of vague. We know that's going to be Brexit and the immigration crisis and that sort of thing, because they do talk about Europe, the migration, growth, reform, vision, unity. So, of course, they're going to be talking about Brexit and immigration issues. And then the usual stuff you would expect, like China, Middle East, Russia, U.S. political landscape, the elections, in other words. Cybersecurity, that's been there for a while. Geopolitics of energy, you know, what's going on with oil? You know, this is, of course, you're going to have those things. But then this stuck out, something I hadn't seen before. Number nine, the precariat and the middle class. Precariat. Well, that's a new word to me. I don't really know what that is. So I started looking at it, and it turns out that there is a new book. It's something that has really taken them by storm. It actually came out 2 years ago. It's by a London economist, Guy Standing. And the book is titled The Precariat. And the subtitle is The New Dangerous Class. So how are they going to control all these people whose lives they have ruined with their globalist policies? They have to understand. You know, not only they're not going to directly talk about the Brexit and put that on there, but they need to understand what they have done to people and how they're going to control us. And so he's got a plan for this. And I want to talk about that. Before I do, real quickly, I want to just take a quick look at how the mainstream media is now not only covering Bilderberg, but how they cover it. And I thought it was kind of interesting because there's an article from CNBC, Bilderberg, the world's most powerful, flock to an annual secret meeting. Well, you know, one of the reasons it was secret was because outlets like CNBC wouldn't report it. Or places like the Wall Street Journal, even though they would send reporters there. And, of course, you got Peggy Noonan and other people. Bloomberg is there. All these reporters from mainstream media, they go there, but they don't report on it. The owners of the paper will go, but they don't report on it. Reporters will go. They don't report on it. So it's a secret. And if you reported on it, you're laughed at. There's, I don't know, these conspiracy theorists, you know, just like they laughed at everybody, and it was amazing the rapidity of which this all got reversed. As I've pointed out before, we have talked for so long about the missing classified 28 pages of the 9/11 report, and we've had high-power politicians who are on the 9/11 Commission who, for 15 years, have been trying to get people to pay attention to this and saying, this needs to be released. We've had Walter Jones on multiple times talking about it. And we couldn't get any traction with anybody. They would just say, oh, you know, it's not going, that's a conspiracy theory. And then Donald Trump brought it up. And the National Review said he sounds like an Alex Jones caller in the debate because he's talking about the secret 28 pages. But then it got traction. Isn't that interesting? It got traction. And now 9/11 is back on the table. And when people realize there's a cover-up, when people realize they've been lied to, they say, well, what else have you been lying to us about? And then that gives us a chance to talk about the real lie, the official 9/11 report. And that lets this whole thing start to unravel. But we get back to Bilderberg. All these people who've said, you know, conspiracy theory, they keep, now they're laying it out. And they're telling you the same types of stuff that we have told you in the past. Over the years, there's been numerous rumors of career launches and future presidents decided at Bilderberg. This is CNBC saying this, mainstream media. I thought that was a conspiracy theory. They said Bill Clinton was a conference attendee in 1991 as a mere governor of Arkansas a year before he was elected U.S. president. Tony Blair was only a shadow minister when he got his invitation in 1993. And, of course, you know, they quote the Independent, because the Independent's saying that too now. Okay? Then they go on to talk about all the people that are there, people from Shell, Deutsche Bank, Siemens, Henry Kissinger, former head of the European Commission is there. Also, the head of the IMF, and also of the World Economic Forum, and then the King of the Netherlands, okay, all this stuff there. So then you get to Slate, who was just last week calling Alex Jones a wild-eyed conspiracy theorist, and now they talk about the Bilderberg blackout. But wait a minute, Slate, but I thought it was a conspiracy theory. I thought all this stuff that we cover, you know, about the 9/11 cover-up and Bilderberg, and all that was just a conspiracy theory, wasn't it, Slate? Even they are jumping in on this. I think it's really funny. And again, they go down with Bill Clinton, Tony Blair. They talk about John Kerry and how he made John Edwards his vice presidential pick after he impressed attendees at a Bilderberg meeting, and so forth and so on. They say the meeting of 120 world figures probably constitutes some kind of news, yet to be fair to the mainstream press, it's tough to report from a private gathering that's locked down tight by professional security. Yeah, so don't even try, okay? But we do. We go there. We show you what it is. We show you the military, the police that are out there. It's kind of, it's like the guy that Rob Dew was talking to with Alex. Rob Dew tried to get the German military, who's guarding these people, to talk to him. They wouldn't talk to him. They wouldn't come over to the gate. Then they saw him over at the gate talking to some German citizens. So he walked over there, and immediately the guy clammed up and walked away. But Rob started talking to the elderly couple that was there, started explaining it to them. And it's really hard to not believe somebody when you say, yeah, it's 120 of the most powerful people in the world are meeting here, and they can see the military protecting this place. And the military will only say, yeah, it's just an event. We won't use the word Bilderberg. Can't say that. Can't say the word Bilderberg. It's secret. But even Salon, even though they can't ignore it anymore, see, because we've put it out there. We show it. And just as this German couple is seeing it there, that's why we go there. We say, yeah, they say this isn't happening, but here it is. And we've got some releases of previous meetings where we can see early on the first meeting. They were planning the common currency, the euro. There were other meetings where they planned the European Union creating a United States of Europe, but it was the euro was first introduced at a Bilderberg meeting. And, of course, this isn't the only group. And Salon kind of mocks it. Yeah, say, all right, it's a secret meeting, but, you know, there's still a lot of crazy conspiracies out there about this. And they come in and say, well, what's going on? Where are the Japanese, the Indians, the Chinese, the Brazilians, Australians, South Koreans? Are they so timid that they stand aside and let the Bilderbergers have their way with the world without even making a peep? Oh, so it must not really be a very important meeting. This is a meeting for European and North American politicians. And they have multiple meetings. They're happening every couple of months all over the place. This is one of a lot of these elite meetings. And we point that out every time we talk about Bilderberg. They still don't get it. They still don't understand what this is about. And they can't ignore it, but they do want to talk about it. So let's talk about what they're going to be covering at Bilderberg. Just from their own admission, they're going to be talking about this idea of the precariat. And this is a term that was created by Guy Standing. He's a UK economist. His book, The Precariat, came out in 2014. As I mentioned before, the subtitle is The New Dangerous Class. And here, I'm going to read a little bit of this description on Amazon.com to give you an idea of what this is about. Guy Standing warns that the rapid growth of the precariat is producing instabilities in society. It is dangerous. It's a dangerous class of people because it's internally divided, leading to the villainization of migrants and other vulnerable groups. Its members may be susceptible to the siren calls of political extremism. And he argues for a new politics in which redistribution and progressive policies will get us all under control. Very interesting. Look at some of the other reviews here that people, comments they've made. Standing shows that the condition of work and politics are subtly and brutally related, likewise related to the slowly clarifying crisis of American democracy, one person put in here. Exactly. That's what you're going to see. And if I look at the first chapter here, where he starts to define what the precariat is, he says in his own book here, the creation of a global precariat consisting of many millions around the world without an anchor of stability. See, this guy, I'm sure I haven't read the book completely yet. I've just started reading the first couple of chapters. I picked chapter 1 and chapter 4 here to start going through. I can tell you, if he's a UK economist and if he wants to break down his analysis of everything into classes of people, I can pretty much guess that he's not a... he's not a libertarian economist, okay? He is some kind of a neo-Marxist of some stripe. And, of course, precariat harkens back to the proletariat that Marx gave us. You know, this is the underclass, the people who now they believe are dangerously precarious. Why? Because of what they have done to us. You're probably part of the precariat. Let me read you what he says, this anchor they're taking away the anchor of stability from the world. They're becoming a new dangerous class. They're prone to listen to ugly voices and vote for people who want to change this globalism. You know, people like Donald Trump, those ugly voices that they keep telling us are ugly voices. And to use their votes and their money to give those ugly voices a political platform of increasing influence. This is what they're reading at Bilderberg. How do we control these people? How do we keep them in this United States of Europe that we've created? How do we keep Britain from leaving? How do we control these people? They're not happy with the euro. This thing is a basket case, this currency. They're not happy with our open borders that's destroying their country. And they're going to do something about it. Some of these people are going to leave. And if Britain leaves, it's going to trigger a lot of these types of exits all over Europe. And they say this comes from a neoliberal agenda. They admit it, that embraced to a greater or lesser extent by governments of all complexions and has created an incipient political monster. This is his words. Action is needed before that monster comes to life. Guess what? They're pretty scared of us, aren't they? They're pretty scared. So they're talking about the precariat. Now, here's an example. The precariat stirred, he says. In 1989, the city of Prato, a short distance from Florence in Italy, was almost entirely Italian. It had 180,000 residents. That year, a group of 38 Chinese workers arrived and a new breed of garment firms began to emerge. They imported more and more Chinese laborers, okay? The importation of workers, the exportation of jobs. These are the policies of globalization that these people at Bilderberg have given us. Now, what happened? That was the situation in 1989. Basically, 180,000 residents, this Italian city, and just 38 Chinese workers come. By 2008, there were 4,200 Chinese companies registered in the city, 45,000 Chinese workers. So they go from 38 Chinese workers to 45,000 Chinese workers. And there are 4,200 Chinese firms. They're making up one-fifth of the city's population. They were producing 1 million garments every day, enough to dress the world's population in 20 years, according to calculations by the city officials. Meanwhile, undercut by the Chinese, buffeted by competition from India and Bangladesh, local Italian firms shed workers in droves. And by 2010, they only had 20,000 Italians working in this town, 11,000 fewer than in 2000. In other words, a full third of the people had lost their jobs. Then came the financial shock, which hit Prato in much the same way as it did many of the old industrial areas of Europe and North America. Bankruptcies multiplied, unemployment rose, and resentment turned nasty. Oh, well, they shouldn't be afraid. They shouldn't be angry about that. I mean, you know, you got the globalists are making a lot of money, and you're getting those cheap goods. Isn't that great? But you have no job. See, same thing is going to happen in spades with robots. And that's the other issue that's coming. It's not even going to be about immigrants. It's going to be about technology displacement. But listen to what happened. Within months, the political left had been swept from power by what this Guy Standing, calls the xenophobic Northern League. Oh, they're afraid of foreigners. Why would they be afraid of foreigners? They've only overrun their city and made a third of the people lose their jobs, okay? Why should we be concerned about that? No problem. So what happened was they elected a new government there, and they started deporting these people. They launched nighttime raids on the factories and the sweatshops. Hey, we wouldn't want to launch a raid on a sweatshop. I mean, we wouldn't want to do that, right? Rounding up workers, demonizing them. Just as the Northern League's political ally, Prime Minister Silvio Berlusconi, spoke of his determination to defeat, quote, the army of evil, as he described illegal immigrants. Okay? Bizarrely, they say, the Chinese government seemed reluctant to take the migrants back. No, they don't want them back any more than the Mexican government would take back Mexican immigrants. They don't want them back. They want them out of the country. They want them in your country, they say. The Chinese built up a community within a community. This is part of the problem. Chinese gangs reportedly organized the exodus from China, and they ran the enclave. Oh, you mean kind of like the mules and the gangs and the organized crime that is running illegal immigration over our border. See, same thing happened in Italy. Same thing happened in Italy that is happening here. They ran the enclave. They were vying for control with gangs from Russia, from Albania, from Nigeria, from Romania, as well as the Italian mafia. So organized crime is running all of the illegal immigrants there. And they are trying to set up a monopoly over these sweatshops, creating slave labor in a town that used to be 100% Italian. And within about 20 years, they have lost a third of their jobs. They're overrun with Chinese gangs. Chinese gangs linking up with Chinese companies, investing in Italian infrastructure projects, taking over the country. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. In this last segment, I want to conclude, summarize what this precariat is. Because this guy Standing, who wrote this book 4 years ago, talked about the dangerous emerging class. He called it a monster that is emerging, and how these elites have to control it. And of course, he says, well, we got four different classes. He says, we got tiny, super rich elite. Okay. He says their relationship with the rest of humanity appears to be fleeting at best. Then there's the salitariat, people on salaries. Okay. Who still maintain their career privileges of pensions, holidays, other employment benefits. In other words, the minions of that super rich elite class. Alongside the salitariat are the professional technicians or proficients, okay? Then he said we have some highly paid consultants and so forth and so on. Then there's the precariat, the proletariat, that is dangerously precarious position, this volatile political movement. And this is something that we have seen throughout history. That example that I just read you in the last section there about the city of Prato from 1989 to 2008, okay, short period, 20, 30 years there. Okay, 20 years. What happened to transform that town there? And what we're looking at here are political, technological, economic forces that are changing Italy and changing America in the same way. And this small town that he picks as an example is something that is going to be happening in America. We're at the stage right now where people are looking at the results of NAFTA, looking at what's going on with the TPP, the TTIP, and saying, that's enough. Stop. We're not going to do that. We know where this leads. We've already seen what happened with NAFTA. We've seen what happened in Italy and so forth. We're going to stop this. And we can see what happens as well in the ancillary issues in terms of the organized crime, the influence of these different mafia groups that come in as part of this. It reminds me very much of what happened in the 1860s. You know, that's the time of the American Civil War. And of course, we're all told in our government schools that it was simply a war about the liberation of slavery, okay? It wasn't. It wasn't. It may surprise you to know that at the same time we had our Civil War, there were massive forces that were happening in Europe as well. It was a consolidation of regional power centers into a concentrated, consolidated nation state. Just like the United States, Italy at that time was broken into a lot of different power regions that were pretty much separate and autonomous. There wasn't a central state. And they had a civil war in the 1860s, just as we do. And Garibaldi's army, look it up. Take a look at what's happening in that period of time in Italy. You've got agrarian interests, who basically had been the power center, the landed agrarian interest, and taking on the new industrial class. The new industrial class became the predominant class, and they established the centralized, concentrated nation state. Same thing happened in Italy that happened here. Agrarian versus industrial. The industrial side won. They created a concentrated, consolidated nation state. Slavery wasn't even an issue there. They used slavery, that was a small part of the issue here. They used that here to give them the moral high ground for a conflict that was happening everywhere. We are at the cusp of a similar major turn in history. As we've talked about many times, the fourth turning. We are at the point now where there is a major move to consolidate from that powerful nation state to a global government. And they're very worried about the precariat, because that's where the balance of power is going to be held if we can wake people up. Join us tonight, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern, for the Nightly News.